It's Robert Kelly's You Know What Do podcast on riotcast.com.
All right, everybody, welcome to YKWD. This is Tim Dillon filling in for Bob Kelly, who's in L.A.
Timmy!
I appreciate that.
This just became Long Island local radio.
This is...
Welcome to Suffolk County's You Know What, Dude.
We're going to be in Levittown tonight.
From the Long Island Expressway show.
It's like if Bobby Kelly franchised out YKWD to shitty markets.
Just fat, angry guys across the country.
Hey, dude, you bought into my YKWD franchise. I get 20% off the top. Bobby takes the rest.
By the way, we're giving away 2 free tickets to Luigi's out there in Melville.
Yeah. Oh man, it's good to be here. We're gonna go through the room. We got a lot of the funniest comics.
You could do what Bobby does and make Scopo.
We're gonna do exactly what Bobby does at 100%.
Introduce everybody, because then you don't have to worry about the pressure of introducing everybody.
No. We're gonna have Scopo do it. This is what he does, and he does it well.
Queens accent coming at you right now.
Here we go.
How you doing? To our far left, we have Ramon Rivas.
Hello.
From Cleveland.
Cleveland, Ohio, Cleveland. City of Champions.
City of Champions.
Oh, okay. Yeah. See that?
There you go.
Oh, man.
I like one.
Relax.
Got another Hispanic person on the end of the table. It's nice.
Yeah, man.
Well,
yeah.
It
balanced out the brown.
Well, we have to have you here, you know, for diversity.
Yeah. Right.
That equals one black.
Two black. Well, you're like not really.
I'm a half Puerto Rican.
You're half Puerto Rican.
What's the other half?
Italian-Irish.
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 Hey, Bazan.
Pure white. White is right.
Yeah.
Hilarious. I didn't know you were Italian.
Yeah, bro.
It's so funny. When I hear someone's Italian, I just start liking them better instantly. Just get excited. No, Italians have that thing.
Yeah.
It just went up 100%. I was like, I fucking knew I liked this.
I knew I hung with Lewis for a reason.
Yeah. I knew I liked this
just
kid.
Just figured it out.
Yeah.
So the Italian side is the real
Scopo,
ass.
Scopo, take control
and intro
the fucking show.
No, that's not me. It's Tim Dillon's part.
Yeah, okay.
No, you're right. Intro in the show
it's
now.
It's a mess.
Tim threw it over to you.
This is your time.
Then we have Dave Smith, everybody.
What's up? Thanks, guys. That's nice.
Let's go through it quick. Then we have Paul Verzi.
Ooh, Verzi!
Verzi!
Flood City himself is back. Giannis Pappas.
Giannis Pappas.
What's that mean? What's Flood City mean?
I make girls squirt. That's what that
oh!
means. Maybe you're not a fan of this show.
Yeah, Flood
blah,
City.
Blah, blah, blah.
Black comics. I got my rag right here. The Puerto Rican rattlesnake, the real ass dude himself, Luis J. Gomez.
Yes, I am here.
There you go.
Thanks for applauding for me, you fucking cocksucker.
Italian
Lewis. He's 25% Italian.
Hey.
That's all right. You'll take it.
It's better than all Puerto Rican.
Yep.
It's right.
How, are you 100% Italian?
No.
You're not Italian at all.
Why do you think
like, I'm not even Italian.
I'm half. My mother's 100% Greek.
Yeah, he's half and half.
Oh, okay, but that's they're close.
You're Greek,
Italian
too.
And Greek are close.
My mother's 100% Greek. My father's 100% Sicilian.
I'm Greek, too.
Are you?
Yeah.
If you live in Queens,
Greek.
You have to be Greek.
All right. I didn't know that. Now I just like you better now.
Yeah, Irish, Italian, and Greek. Yeah.
Tim, dude, what are you, 100% Irish?
I'm Irish, a little German.
Yeah, dude, Greek,
Irish 100, but it's
Greek
Irish.
Girls are so fucking hot, and Greek dudes are so disgusting.
Excuse us?
It really is.
Whoa.
Like, if you look at, like, all Greek chicks are fucking smoking hot across the board.
Not
and then
all.
Every time, yeah, they are. They're fucking hot.
Yeah?
Every one of them.
You're going to... take a firm stance on every one of them.
100%.
There's not a single unattractive Greek woman.
Yeah, they are.
There's not one. Not your Greek fucking great grandmother. That bitch is hot.
But every time I meet a Greek dude, it's like a fucking hairy, like...
Oh, really?
...greasy looking motherfucker.
You're looking right at one that Lauren happens to be attracted to.
Hold on. Are you attracted to Giannis,
absolutely.
Lauren?
Absolutely.
No.
Lauren, what are you? What nationality are you?
I'm Italian.
A full, all Italian?
Full bred.
Sicilian or no?
No. Abruzzi.
Brutti.
What about John Stamos? We're just going to forget about John Stamos?
Oh, yeah, you know what? I take it back. There's one. There's one attractive...
attractive Greek dude?
Yeah, Greek guy. And that's it. Like, Italians can be attractive. Puerto Ricans can be attractive. Greeks, just the women.
You know?
Irish people have it right. Irish women. They're,
well, you heard it there from Louis J. Gomez.
Louis J. Gomez on Twitter. You can go find him.
What if we just replaced, like, a sociology professor with Louis?
With Louis?
I'm like, that's just how, that's just how your first
better.
Day of class started.
I think it would be better.
Let's break down the Greeks real quick. All right, this is going to take all of 3 minutes. The chicks are hot, every last one of them.
No, you're right, though. You were going to say Irish chicks are one or the other. They're
Irish chicks
are beautiful, or it's an absolute shit show.
They look like cabbages. Many of them. They age.
Well, that's just
the thing.
True.
They're hot until like about 40,
and
then
that's
they all.
It.
Well, that's
they
just
age
evolution.
Horribly.
It's not
well,
one or the other, though. I would
die.
Say.
Yeah.
I would say it's like maybe 10% of Irish chicks are hot. Like one out of every 10.
There's a few, but then there's a lot of masculine Irish chicks.
Yeah. English, Irish, Scottish, that's just a fucking disgusting.
Those are the chicks who will help you move.
Yeah.
Those are you know, in the early in like the 20s in New York, the Irish maids were called, like the maid was called a Bridget because it was always an Irish chick who was like a hard scrabble. Nasty, gross. You'd walk in your apartment and just a disgusting Irish chick would get, and then go home and get her ass kicked by her husband. And that's how Irish chicks evolved into these monsters.
That's why they have such thick foreheads.
Yeah, like when I grew up, yeah, no, dude, when I grew up, I was surrounded by hard Irish women with psoriasis and sunburns and dude, smoke cigarettes and ash into like the seashells and just sit out there hammered and go, fuck you! And like that's
those chicks are scary when you're a kid. Those are the type of women who will like hit other people's kids.
Yeah.
They will. I've seen an Irish woman just wail on somebody. Like, absolutely.
Yeah. Just Boston moms with like four-leaf clover tattoos.
Have you ever been hit by another adult as a kid?
Yeah.
Who'd you get hit by,
dude? We got this fucking woman. I mean, we were young. We might have been in like fourth grade, but we were like throwing, I think we were throwing water balloons.
You deserve
cars.
It.
Oh yeah, we were being dicks.
At cars, that's not that bad though.
You get what? Are you kidding me?
This woman.
How could it be worse?
You throw it up. How could it be worse?
It's worse.
We were shooting Uzis into our.
Yeah, wasn't it planes?
You throw that on a guy's windshield, he can't see. He fucking crashes.
We used
his
to
car.
Fill them with piss.
Yeah, we were throwing them at moving cars.
Well, he grew up with parents, so there was some rules. He didn't go all the way crowbar to the front of a fucking windshield.
Oh, you used to use water balloons? We used to fill balloons with explosives. And then we would blow up cars. Whatever.
So
they got mad at you for that?
Somebody smacked you because of that?
Yeah, this chick. So this fucking black woman, who I guess the crazy thing was she was walking by, and I guess we had gotten
she didn't
her.
Have a cord, just threw it at her.
No, this was so crazy. We had gotten her, like, I guess a couple weeks earlier. We did this regularly.
Jesus.
So she saw us throwing and put together. She was like, oh, those are the kids who got me. And she chased me, and I ran. And I ran, like, into this
and
apartment
there's
building.
No way you could outrun a black person.
No, I ran into an apartment
Summer
building.
Olympics are happening right now, guys.
Yeah, she was in. This black chick was in amazing shape.
Great
so She just fucking. She passed, like, five people who were running in between us. I was like, she's gaining on me. There were hurdles. No, she caught me in, like, a vestibule of, like, a building. And I couldn't get in because the door was locked. And I was like, oh, shit, I'm trapped. And then she came in and slapped me across the face. And then we both had a weird moment. Like, I think she was kind of like, I just hit a kid.
Start June. Crying?
How old were you?
No, I was just kind of in shock. Fourth grade? Fifth grade? Something like
that. So 13.
Yeah.
Is that?
That's old enough to get
that's
hit.
That's Puerto Rican age in fourth grade.
Yeah.
What kind of day did you need to have to throw shit at people?
What kind of what?
Like, what kind of day did you have to have to, like, let's go reward ourselves?
Someone
knocked
my blocks over in kindergarten. I'm having a bad one.
We used to do pranks. We used to throw eggs. There was a Bally's gym in the town I lived in, and we used to just throw
in
eggs.
Long Island, the Bally's?
Yeah, Bally's gym. And it's where many of my good friends work to this day. Many of them are employed there as personal trainers. And we would throw eggs at the windows in Bally's while people were on the ellipticals and shit, and none of them cared. Like, it was the work, because we would just chuck eggs and nobody gave a shit. So then we started throwing them at cars, and then people, then we got attention.
We threw rocks at cars, dude.
You threw rocks at cars?
We threw rocks at cars on in White Plains.
That's the Greek side of you. just a little piece of shit, animal, Greek, ugly side of you.
I'll never forget it, dude. And there were three of us, and we're just, like, winging them. And we just hit, and we just saw this Cadillac stop and go back.
Jesus.
And they were coming, and they were like, we were going to get the shit. I mean, what we were doing was dangerous and ridiculous.
Right.
And we had to go all the way in these shrubs, like we were like in the middle of a bush, like just scraped. And we ran up and we got out, and cops were there, and they were like, "You guys throwing rocks?" And we're like, "No, no." And they were like, "Get out of here." But the guys,
it's called being white, you know? Yeah. You're throwing rocks? Nah, good, get out of here. You know what I mean? It's like, if you're black, they're like, "You were throwing rocks." I'm like, what?
They talk you into throwing rocks. Yeah. You sure you weren't throwing rocks?
You keep going. We're looking for some black people walking. We're looking for some black people walking.
That's just, how I know.
You just like, cut over to like some black people like coming from book club, and they're like, "All right, book them."
Right. People right, walking guys. Out of church. They're like, "They were throwing rocks."
Rock throwing carries a mandatory minimum sentence of 17 years.
What would you do in Cleveland growing up? Bad shit. Anything bad?
I wasn't allowed to hang out with my bad cousins who were like, they wound up in prison and shit. But like, I just had to stay away from them.
Really?
Yeah.
But were they cool? Did you want to hang out with them?
Yeah, because
they sound
like,
great. Even
yeah,
now.
They had like ninja stars and shit, and they were like
the great weed.
Yeah, they had really
awesome fucking dudes.
They were selling
dudes.
Weed in like middle laid. School and shit. Yeah, probably. Yeah.
Ninja so stars.
Your like, dude, they would like, let you smell their girlfriend's pussies on their fingers. These guys were the best.
Yeah.
And so you were not allowed to go near them.
No, I mean I was, but like it just wasn't like they were just mean to me when I hung out with them. So I just didn't like that.
Yeah. Do you have bad family members, Giannis?
No, but bad family members?
You know, like a guy that they would, like, stay away from.
No.
Uncle.
Like a molester?
I don't know.
No, I didn't have one.
Uncle
I wasn't
Spiro or something, this guy.
Wasn't privileged to have a molester uncle.
Wow. I didn't have a molester either.
Yeah.
Nobody had a molester?
Not a molester.
I had a distant molester.
You sure you didn't have one?
I wish I had one.
Because you
seem
molested, gay.
I seem like I've continually been molested.
Yeah, because you don't seem like a gay guy.
Yeah, you're like,
I seem like
you're
something
straight,
happened.
But you enjoyed a dude sucking your dick at one
a
point.
A lot of the dudes that I go out with had to be molested because my body type is the type that you have to get introduced to young in life. Like very. So I would imagine I go out with are autistic and they look at the ground and I'm like, oh, okay.
Tim, can you only kiss me when I'm sleeping?
Yeah.
You gotta climb into my bed when I'm sleeping.
Right. Man. Afterwards, I make them say, "Let's not tell your parents."
You do Grindr?
I do Grindr. Yeah.
I just picture guys showing up, be like, "Are you sure, dude?"
What's
up, guy? How you doing?
Let's suck my dick tonight.
He's got like a Tennessee Titans jersey.
Yeah. I got this. Bring the check over here. So look, who's sucking whose dick first?
What
no.
What do you get the flamboyant? Yeah. Like, do you get like the? Oh my God! Are those the guys you date or no?
No, not really. I mean, I get those guys like me, but I don't go out with them. But I get like kind of.
I feel like you date old gay dudes.
No, I don't. I date young dudes, like young weird.
Tim, can I? Tell you? I'm convinced dudes. You like, just fuck chicks, and this is all bullshit.
I would be hilarious if I had a fat wife, and then nobody knew.
I
like
this
was
is
just,
fucking brilliant. Yeah. Let me explain to you, dude. Yeah. This is the move, okay?
Me and Lewis hatched this idea. Lewis is like, "Listen, you got to be a fag in comedy if you want to get away
with
this
shit." Times are rough right now.
Lewis would be the guy who would come up with something like that. Be like, "Listen, don't say anything to anyone. I'll cover you. I'll make sure."
That's fucking brilliant.
Yeah, because nobody believes.
Here's what you do. This
guy.
Is how you do to get dude ass, like hot dude ass.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Pretend you're straight.
Got all the answers.
Lewis has all the answers.
Pretend you're straight.
One. Right.
Just say I'm a straight guy and I want to experiment. You will fucking get those little fucking gay dudes that want to get that straight cum.
The funniest thing.
That's high level right there. Yeah. Straight cum is the fucking highest level of cum.
Just imagine it in the sociology class. Straight cum is the highest level of what you guys get. Kids looking like,
that concludes chapter one, Great Kitchens. Now let's move on to where we rank cum.
One of the funniest things Giannis said was when I was doing a show one day and Giannis goes, I feel like if I tried to get into a gay bar, they would be like, "Well, you just hit a gay bash. Why don't you get out of here? You know? What are you here to fucking?"
I feel like if you were like you know, when those religious people will argue
but that's
that
only
being gay is a choice.
Yeah,
I feel like you would be like evidence
of
one.
That. Yeah,
like, you'd
be like, "But that's
here's
only
Tim Dillon. This guy claims to be
but that's
gay."
That's only because only gay dudes you see are with the ones in the out there on TV. And they're the ones that are crying and ice skating and dancing. You know what I mean?
No, like, I know a few gay guys who I'm like, they were born this way. I feel like you're just being a dick.
Well, this is a choice. So I'm just ruining it.
You're just, come
I
on.
Sat down with my manager. He said, you got to be something. It's fat white guys from here to fucking, it's
that has
no
been
good.
Done.
Yeah. What should we call it? What, when you, do you have gay friends? You have a gay friend?
You.
That's it? That doesn't count.
No, I have gay friends. I got a tranny friend.
Great.
I got a bunch of gay friends.
Which tranny friend?
Who's the tranny friend?
She's a friend of mine. She's cool. We go to dinner
sometimes.
She goes
to the stand a lot.
Okay.
Yeah,
she's
oh, I know.
Always, she always goes to Lewis's show.
Yeah, she loves me.
Yeah. Oh, great.
Yeah, she's cool. Yeah. I dig it. I don't give a shit. You do what you want to do with your dick and asshole. I don't give a fuck.
Yeah. Right.
You know, so
yeah.
I'm not
beautiful. Do what you want to do with my dick and asshole, you know? It's free
world. Yeah, I mean, don't tell me what to do with my dick and asshole. I won't tell you what to do with yours.
I agree.
That's 100%.
100%.
Or pussy.
Yeah.
Is there like a big, what's in Cleveland? Is there like the transgender thing is like the newest.
Yeah, I don't think I like. Yeah, I don't think they like being called trannies.
No, transgender.
I'm giving another 5 years.
Okay. Lewis has another 5 years of saying the word tranny.
Yeah,
He's grandfathered in.
Dude, I got another 30 or 40 days for the word nigger still.
If you
isn't it weird though that it's like people of color or colored people, like it's like such a small thing makes so much difference in whether you offend someone.
Yeah, no,
even
huge.
Just tranny or trans, it's just such a funny thing. To fight over, like whether you go E or N, like at the end of the word.
I think that's just like today's, like
it's like the mentality.
It's just cunts, you know.
Well, I think it's like
why are we just gonna change the word every 10 years and then decide the people using the old one are assholes? Like, why are we doing that?
Well, it's the same word. It doesn't matter. Yeah, it doesn't matter. Cares? It's tranny, trans, transgendered. What the fuck does it matter? Yeah. I'm not saying kill that fucking tranny.
Right.
I'm saying, that tranny's kind of cute.
Although it does roll off the tongue, am I right?
Yeah, that does. You sounded very convincing not saying kill that tranny, by the way.
Yeah, you know what's funny is, like, everyone's mad about, like, the word faggot, the word tranny, but you know it's a good one that points out the example that they're just words cocksucker. Nobody brings that up.
Nobody cares.
Because cocksucker, that started
that's
as, like,
a great point.
Yeah, it starts as like a gay pejorative. Yeah. But, like, nobody ever, it doesn't mean that anymore. It means this guy's a dick.
Yeah.
Same, like, faggot doesn't mean, like, oh, let's go bash
that guy.
The Long Island version is cock slob.
Yeah, it means you're a vegan. When you're a faggot, it means you're a vegan.
That guy's a cock slob.
Yeah. Faggot means vegan.
I think faggot is now meaning everything but gay.
Yeah, it's like,
it means
this
like everything
a faggot.
But
faggot
like
was a term of endearment among friends.
Yeah,
you know what it was.
Like, what are you not eating tonight? What are you a faggot?
But here's the thing. Here's the thing, and here's the other side of the argument.
You sucking that dick? What are you a faggot?
People do say it in a hateful way, and so that becomes an issue. People say, "Hey, fuck that faggot!" Like. That's where people
get
angry.
Out where the word came from, and where the word came from was the sticks. They called the sticks fags, and then they burned them. So that's what it originated.
Wait a minute.
Yeah, we all saw that episode of Louis too, you faggot.
I didn't even see it from Louis. I was actually told that.
I didn't. And what is it? The sticks?
In England, they called the sticks
cigarettes.
Fags. They called them fags.
Right.
And they would say burn it, and then
burn
the gay guy. Yeah.
Right. Well, that's offensive.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's somewhat offensive.
Was that in Louis?
Well, a flaming gay guy is the most gay could ever be.
You can't take the context out of words. You know, it's like
absolutely.
The N word's bad.
But that's
dude.
That's what the culture does now.
But that's the whole point. Is that it's instead of like what Tim was kind of getting at. I think is instead of people being offended by like what the meaning was or what the point someone was making is, it's just become this like, if you hit the no word, people go like, oh, I heard that word, therefore you're bad. It doesn't matter.
Which is horseshit.
Yeah.
Right.
You can't
just
ban
dumb.
Words. Just, you know, it's like, what are we doing?
Didn't that Canadian comic got sued?
Yeah, he just got
our friend, Mike Ward.
Yeah, but I'm friends with Mike, but he got his money. From comics.
Yeah.
Which is great. And he did it quick.
Now what was that, a tribunal? What exactly was the body that found him guilty?
Human rights tribunal.
That's such a scary fucking term.
Yeah. Quebec is where they're really crazy up there. I mean, I guess in all of Canada, like, they don't really have anything like as clear as what we have with the First Amendment. Like, they don't have anything that just like protects you against shit like this.
Yeah.
But I guess only in Quebec are they like really actually crazy enough to go after someone. And it's cool that comics like chip that in, and that's cool that we came together and found a way to like solve that. But how crazy is that?
That's insane.
The government extorted this for tens of thousands of dollars.
I love you just said we came together.
Nobody
in this
room
donated.
I did.
When I do, I mean Paul and his family.
And I couldn't
which
donate.
I consider myself a part of.
You know, he took food out of his kid's mouth so that guy could call that kid a retard.
You know what the funny thing
is? What a noble kind.
When you go to the GoFundMe, though, you can't do the minimum. Like, when you see everybody's, like, some comics gave 10.
Yo,
like,
who the fuck
does do that?
Who does anonymous? Fuck you.
Yeah, fuck
you
anonymous.
Did anonymous? If you're anonymously given, dude.
I share the GoFundMe, and to me, that's my donation.
I feel like 10
I
share it.
By the way, Tim.
I pass the buck.
By the way, I completely agree, because I feel like my my power as an influencer is going to be more valuable than the $40 that I'm going
to
donate.
I don't need to give you $20. I'm going to share the GoFundMe.
that's potentially worth
I'm sick of GoFundMe, because there are GoFundMes. There's a guy in Long Island who's a comic who has a GoFundMe and goes like this, hey, my car is a year, I probably got a year left on the car. And the guy's like, I really want to see my kids. Let's fucking help me out. I'm like, I've never owned a car that I confidently said, oh, in a year this could be, you know. So some of these things are insane.
If I'm going to donate money to your GoFundMe, your kid better be dying, or you better, like, it better be something crazy.
Crazy.
I'm not going to share it.
The one where
crazy.
The comic's daughter just died.
Wait, that's really sad.
That
Marshall
was
Brandon.
A sad one. Yeah,
he's a great comic.
The comic's daughter.
Who? Marshall Brandon, really funny guy.
Oh, my God.
His
what
daughter
happened?
Died. Very sad. Unexpected.
Oh, no.
That's the type of shit you donate to.
Shit.
You know?
Well, I'll donate to that one if you give it to me.
All right, everybody listening, that's the new bar. All right?
That's
so
it.
So if you're trying to set up a GoFundMe,
if your child has not died,
fuck your kidneys.
That. Yeah, that's it. Have you ever set up a GoFundMe for anything?
No. I always feel weird about, like, begging for money for my fans.
Yeah.
I did.
Sell a t-shirt. I don't know.
Yeah, I did years ago. We made a comedy documentary. We did a GoFundMe with it. And it was all people who had been coming to comedy shows in Cleveland for years.
Right.
And then we filmed it and then edited it
all
together.
You're a big force in that scene down there. And people have said you're the reason there's a comedy scene.
Yeah, like I run this thing called accidentalcomedy.com, so it's like a bunch of weekly and monthly shows and then a yearly comedy festival, so it's just like a dense.
Right,
like,
right.
It's like
I just imagine your cousins are using that website to launder money.
Yeah, for sure.
What do you think about, there's a comedy festival in New York that was really... it was controversial because it's called the Cinderblock Festival, and they were charging white dudes. I think it was kind of like a joke or a gag where they're charging white guys.
It wasn't a gag.
It wasn't a gag.
It wasn't a fucking gag.
Okay, it wasn't
Tim.
A gag. Okay, it wasn't
and
a gag.
And I get that you don't count as a white guy because you're a fucking
fruit bat.
No,
they booked me on the thing. I said no, but they booked me as paid.
A fruit bag. I like that
one. A fruit
bet.
But here's, to explain to people.
I actually like
people,
fruit bag.
What a fruit
like
bat is.
Bag,
yeah, what a fruit bat is. Explain
a fucking bag of mangoes.
No, what did they were charging. They were charging white guys more money.
And that was a good promotional tool because that made so many people talk about, like, there's so many festivals now, it's hard to kind of stand out. So them doing that just made everyone mad, but it also got them a lot of coverage.
Good old discrimination gets some good coverage.
They,
they
charge a $25 fee to submit, right? As a young comic, you pay $25 to watch your tape, see if you can get in this festival. And if you were a minority or a woman, they charge you 77 cents on the dollar. Because
that's how much women supposedly get paid.
That's the idea. It was this cute thing, but it was like fuck straight white guys, basically.
Cute little thing.
It was just fuck straight white guys.
I like that you got mad because you're not straight white.
I know.
Yeah,
fuck that.
You are.
One thing I like about Lewis, and speaking as a straight white guy, Lewis always takes up the mantle of straight white guys.
Yeah.
I appreciate
that. I really wish
very
I were white.
Very few people do. Yeah.
No,
but that's
like
honest.
That.
I like that.
No, but
I
Lewis,
like that.
Lewis has a very balanced
like
perspective on race.
You know?
Lewis is very like, call him how he sees him. Because you'll
I was raised in a white household.
But I'm saying, but you'll side against white people in certain situations.
Yeah.
Or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. It's,
Lewis
I,
sides.
I think,
how old were you when you stopped? When you were like, I don't. I wish I wasn't Hispanic. Like, when did that
start? Lewis doesn't give a fuck about anything.
Yeah, Lewis doesn't care about his race.
He's got a middle initial in his name, and he looks
white,
like that.
That means you don't.
I'm kidding about that, but what's funny is when I was a little kid, I really did want to be white. Because I was in my neighborhood, I grew up on a block that was, like, all white trash. So they used to, like, beat me up and call me a nigger and a spick and fucking spit on me. And I used to wish I was white. I used to say that. And, you know, Italian Irish racist family that wouldn't even like correct me.
Yeah.
They'd be like, "Hey, I get it." That boy's got a strong argument.
We know.
Yeah, he's
we
got
know.
Dreams. He's got Look, dreams.
Those guys out there in the street, they got a point. No.
Yeah, you gotta see that. You gotta see things from their point of view.
Maybe one day we can fix this.
Like, imagine you're them and this big brown kid just comes right at you.
Yeah.
What are you gonna do?
Right.
I'll give him a nice licking.
Yeah. Keep saying your prayers. Maybe it'll happen.
You're one of the lucky ones.
Yeah.
You know what nobody admits? You know what nobody admits? Nobody admits when they move into a neighborhood that, like, you gotta find out what's in the neighborhood, you know?
What
do you mean? Nobody.
That was so Italian.
No, nobody admits. Because here's
that
the
was
thing.
Italian.
What?
That was very.
That was
Italian.
So Italian.
Because you know what house the neighborhood.
No, I'm not trying to be racist. I'm just saying. It's a weird thing that nobody admits.
back in the neighborhood.
That is
you're
gonna
tell me you don't care how many fucking blacks are in your neighborhood.
No, it's not even that. It's like I look at the like the property value of the schools, and when you talk to a real estate agent, that is like an underlying thing that's out there, and nobody talks. Because when people go, hey, how's the neighborhood? How's the neighborhood is white people code for are there minorities there? Yeah. It just is. So when you say that to a real estate agent, he knows, and he knows, hey, the neighborhoods are really good.
You've got deer in your neighborhood. You have pictures of fucking deer like you put up on Facebook.
There's some minorities in my neighborhood, but the numbers are
low.
They're deer.
I'm
not saying that's a good thing or a bad thing, but it's definitely not a bad thing.
I don't know what I'm saying, but...
Not saying good or bad, but definitely not bad.
No, you're right. It's here's the plight of the fucking white guy, and this is something me and Ramon can like, you know, kind of. It's a little advantage that we have. The privilege of being a brown person in America today is you could just kind of say racist shit. I could say that. You can't really
say
that.
Well, white people, the thing about it is every white people are the only ones, or it seems really white men or straight white men or whatever, are the only ones held to this standard. Everybody else is kind of like, say whatever you want to, but we're going to put what white men say under a microscope, and if it's deemed slightly offensive, then we're going to jump all over it. It's just fucking... But look, this thing with the Cinder Block Festival, like, they got... like traction and people were talking about him because of that, but like we've said this before, it's fucking disgusting to run a festival based off charging comics to submit.
I mean, let me ask you a question, what was cool about watching
Skankfest unfold was like you guys just completely, and because you're at a point where like you were able to get sponsors and all that type of shit, where like most festivals starting out don't really have
We didn't get sponsors.
Okay.
Well, I mean, we did it after the fact, but we booked it. And
if any are listening,
we booked it
next year.
We had a fan base built into our podcast, and we booked professional, really funny comedians, and word of mouth, you know, kind of let it take off. And that was that. You have to spend the money. It's a business. You can't just go, you can't come out and go, oh, I'm just going to fucking charge, you know, 1,000 comics, $25 each, and then start $25K. Profit and go, all right,
I mean, look,
I'm gonna
you
put
can
that
do
in my
it,
pocket.
But it's just a shitty way to do it. And then to do that and
then
try
pretend.
To disguise it as something noble because you're charging
like
straight white men more money.
Yeah.
Like, fuck you, dude.
You're still charging.
Just,
you're still charging minorities.
Yeah, you're still ripping them
money.
Off.
You're still ripping
them off.
Less.
Yeah.
Ripping them
off
less.
Like for my festival, like I do a mix of like invitation and then like submissions for the last few spots. But then I rent out the whole Cleveland hostel, so everyone who comes to Cleveland has somewhere to stay.
Yeah.
Because so many festivals, you just kind of fucked when you get there. You just kind of have to find a couch to crash on and like come out of your pocket for a hotel room. So,
the thing with the minorities and women.
What is it with us, Paul?
Sociology lesson
the
number
thing.
Five.
Parenthetical, the thing. The problem.
Yeah.
No.
The thing.
But Lewis said Lewis said something before, and it is a problem. It's that because I've had. And I'm not going to mention names. I don't want people to get in trouble with their jobs. But I've had networks say, look, dude, I'm just telling you right now, they want women. They're going heavy on women. They're going heavy on women. And when people say, when a straight white dude goes, all right, well, that's kind of fucked up. The thing that's cool now to say is, well, you guys had your time. That's the acceptance that people, like you guys been crushing it. You guys been crushing it forever. Let other people. And it's also like, well, look at the stats. There's more of us.
Yeah, have you
it's
thought about
up.
Like tootsying it? And like going
no.
as related.
That's
no.
it. That's it. Change to tell you.
Yeah.
I grew up in the Lower East Side of New York City.
Right.
That's change to tell you.
That'd be hilarious if you just called me up one day. You're like, dude.
But
I just
started living as her.
Can I get the next spot of Caroline? Is there a free guest spot that I could do? You have to. You have a funeral for Giannis. You speak at it.
He's a straight white oppressor. He's done.
No, look, diversity is a good thing, man.
It's a
it
good
is
thing.
A good thing.
And
it
listen,
thing.
And
is it a good thing? I was just in LA for 2 months, and I was the only brown comic on most shows, maybe one or two others, unless it was like a Mo Better Mondays or Chocolate Sundays or like Baron Vaughn's New Negroes. But that's because
you just named
I don't.
Like
that show's been around for 200 years.
You
and
just
I don't,
named, unless it was this one now.
Those are three shows in like
a
city
week.
With. Yeah.
Right. No, I know.
But that's because I don't look at it. I don't think it's diverse because I don't count women or gay people as diversity because they're usually white. Because
they're not
like
people.
Color wise, it's
right.
still very monochromatic.
Right.
Yeah, but look,
but it may
overall,
be diverse.
If you look at comedy to say, I mean, I'm not saying diversity, I actually think is
I think
fine.
It's from point
it's,
of view.
It's great. I think talent is what. what's really interesting.
Diversity
in comedy,
for the sake of diversity.
Yes,
exactly.
But the idea that you would look at comedy and feel like there needs in any way to be some forced diversity. Comedy has historically been dominated by blacks and Jews. It's been it's been an area where some of the most persecuted groups have been able to dominate. The idea that you need to force it in and go, well, what's the Asian count this year or the Mexican count?
Great point.
This is fucking ridiculous.
That's what the service is.
It's ridiculous.
Hold on, guys.
I never thought of it that way.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Smith,
white power. What power? What power?
Oh, no, I'm applauding.
What is right?
And I'm going to tell you something, though. Here's the problem with the Jews, though.
What power?
I just don't buy it. I do love diversity about comedy, but when I think of comedy, like the diversity, it's
Listen, it's the same type of black guy. It's the same type of gay dude. It's not diverse unless you have me sucking a dick. It's not diverse to have a gay dude.
That just sounds wrong.
It's
your big old fucking paws.
But that's diversity.
You squeeze a fucking mayonnaise and ketchup onto it.
It's not diverse.
No, but you're absolutely. That's a fucking. But that's a brilliant point. It's like some 26-year-old kid in patty pants who fucking sucks. Who got you know high up at some company because they fucking they brown nose the whole time. And then they're like, yeah, we need diversity, meaning the same exact black character, the same exact gay character,
the same exact guy.
It's like this isn't diversity at all. You're
diverse.
This is fucking boring.
And even you see that SNL fired 3 people today.
Yeah,
crazy.
I just love how they were having a serious conversation about diversity in comedy, and they were talking about Tim's hands holding a cock.
Yeah, listen, I'll say you
jerked off by your contractor.
But what a great thing! What a great thing to have
the pavement outside.
To have your contractor jerk
you off. Do your pavement, and then these paws are gonna grip that meat sausage.
Like the whole time he's jerking you off, you're like, does this change the price we agreed to?
Dan Sitchman had a great point. It sounds like I'm like a foreman at a union that tells everybody, listen,
Anthony, get over here.
The jobs are being cut. I am gay. Also, please sign up for health insurance if you need it.
But, you know, when it comes to comedy, everything comes out in the wash. You know, if you get something because you fit a demographic that the network's trying to promote, that's business. You know, that's what it is. And comedy comes out in the wash. Like, if you're not funny, you don't have chops eventually.
Yeah, but can I say this, though? People are sheep in that they don't actually know what they like. Yeah. The reason that NBC still fucking exists is because they go, all right, we're just going to trust NBC to put the best show on. And then they go, oh, okay, I like it. Does everybody else like it? Okay, I like that too.
Yeah.
So if they're pushing a specific thing, if they're pushing an Asian woman in place of a dude, it's not like it's a market demand. They're kind of creating that thing.
But it does. It has bad consequences too. I mean, look, you can look at on Comedy Central with the news shows, like they clearly made a push to be like, now that Stewart and Colbert were gone, to make it a more like diverse group. And it's like, okay, well,
it's
fucking
not doing
tanking.
Good.
It's tanking, and
that's right. I want to go to black people for my politics.
But I think there were these.
The problem is
there were a lot of people when it was Jon Stewart and
Street
Colbert,
justice, baby.
Because they're like lefty
guys. Media takeout.
But you know, a lot of people used to complain about those two. The liberal complaint would be like, oh, it's just more white men. And even when that cancel Colbert thing came up, that really came out that a lot of people were like, oh, you know, if they're so liberal, how come it's just white men up there? And people just underestimated the fucking talent that Stewart and Colbert had. They're fucking brilliant comedians.
God. Stewart made that show.
If you think you're just going to find another guy like that,
he made it.
Huh?
He made the show.
He made that show.
He made the whole show.
Think about it. The show was around before him. It was the Daily
Show
was there.
Like,
and then he made
like
it his own.
Who was it?
Craig Kilborn.
Yeah, it was Kilborn.
Who did they fire from SNL? Jay Farrow. John Rudnitsky.
Yeah.
Retiring Kilborn. Talented guy.
I don't know Taron. I don't know the other guy. I know Taron Jay. And I know
they don't tell you why they fire you from SNL.
No,
that's what they all said.
He's cold-blooded. No, Lauren Michaels is cold-blooded.
No, Taron Killam was in like almost every
everything. He was the glue dude. He was a glue dude.
And Jay, both of them were in their sixth year with one more year on the contract.
Jay was the shocking one because he did a lot of shit on that show. He did Obama.
Yeah, Jay's a cool guy, too.
He did a lot of impressions.
Great impressions.
Yeah. He did. Yeah. Thanks, Scopo.
You did you ever audition for Saturday Night Live, Giannis?
Long time ago.
Huh? Long time ago. Yeah. Long when I first started doing.
What impressions did you do?
It was funny because they make you sign a contract before you get on stage, which is crazy.
Wow.
Before the audition,
they own you.
They own you just in case Lauren Michaels likes you, you're already signed. You can't.
Wow.
Get known to, you're locked in and. You know, he gets a piece of you, like, if you keep going, you know.
Well, okay.
Smack.
And what do? You do characters and
when
stuff?
I did it was the year Rob Riggle got it.
Okay.
So it was
what year was that?
This was 2004.
Okay.
Five, maybe.
Jesus Christ, Giannis, how old are you?
75.
77. Yeah.
I've been around a long time.
It's like, yeah. It's like they went with Steve Martin.
I've seen a lot of you guys.
Giannis, like, it was the year that Steve Martin got it. Gilda Radner, my girlfriend, got it. But
I've
I
seen
was
a lot of you guys come and go. No. So they yeah, so it was like I did it was at the comic strip, and I did stand up.
Okay.
Because I had a
bad move.
Yeah, I had a friend of mine managing me at the time, who I grew up with.
Sounds
so
good.
I didn't really get the right. I thought
it was such a New Yorker
yeah,
move.
I
not
thought,
Chet.
No, my buddy. And so I thought that it was like there was two auditions. One was stand up. One was like characters when they do the on camera. I didn't know that it was like, here's your audition, and then if you get a callback, it's they want to look at you on camera.
Right.
So I went up there and did stand up, and at that time my stand up was horrific.
Mm. Yeah.
So I basically I didn't do bad, but
do you wish you'd
loop
back around, or are you like,
was
I don't
Lauren there?
What are you gonna do, you know?
Mm-hmm.
My comedy's one failure after the other. My career is one failure after
well,
the
other. Well, that's all comedy is.
Lauren was there, and he walked in, dude, and he's like, he got out of like his fucking like whatever caddy, and he had two chicks with him. I mean, he's like a Don. And
yeah,
then,
he is,
yeah. Yeah, like Tina Fey was there watching. Horatio Sanz was there watching. And, yeah, so that's what it was.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that just kill? Yeah. There, you guys wanted to know.
Tell us about your SNL.
I wanted to hear some fucking impressions or something. I don't know, Giannis. I feel like you were going to bum me out with that story.
We all just quit now. We're like, all right, this isn't heading anywhere good. Let's get the fuck out of here.
16 years ago.
That show's not what it used to be. The thing is that show's trying to stay relevant on TV in an era where nobody watches sketches on TV.
I feel like they did have a little insurgence recently. It got cooler again very recently. Maybe it's because I know some of the cast members.
Sketches.
But
yeah.
I feel like people talk about it again.
Thanks for throwing that out.
And then, like, anytime it's like a political year, they tend to catch like a cultural tailwind.
Yeah,
and, like, because like McKinnon's Clinton impression is really, really good. So, like, they'll probably ride that out for.
But all the clips, you know, everybody watches it and clips online the next day.
Well, that's
know,
the thing. Everybody's watching.
Well, look at Key and Peele, dude. Key and Peele were so fucking funny, and they were like, "Will you guys watch the show and stop giving us millions of like?" They love that they had millions of hits on YouTube,
but
nobody was watching the show.
Yeah, but where's TV? Is TV even going to be a thing in 5 years? Is any going to be watching TV?
I don't,
bro. Does a Conan O'Brien set now matter?
Well, like, what do you think?
You know what I mean? It doesn't seem to.
I think it's a cool thing to have.
No one thing matters anymore.
Yeah. That's what it is.
It's a collective.
Fans
matter.
Getting fucking fans matter.
Go Mites!
That's
it.
That's
form one big.
100% what he just said is if you have people come to see you and you draw, I think podcasts are bigger than TV.
I love it, though. It's pretty amazing, dude, because there's, I mean, me and Lewis talk about this quite a bit, but me and Lewis are definitely guys who, like, I mean, we've been in the comedy scene for a while now at this point, and we are never guys
half the time of Giannis.
Well, I mean,
a quarter of the time.
We're not fucking ancient, but we've been doing this for a little bit. And it's like, we're not guys who have, like all these people in the industry pulling for us. We're just not those guys who are, like, on the track where
well,
it's like,
the episode
you're just going to get this.
I think part of the reason is the episode of your guys' podcast I was on was named To Rape a Retard. So.
I'm not sure if NBC's looking at that like, how do we make this a TV show?
Can we go mainstream with this?
So the other one I was on, Gavin McInnes, tried to rape Lewis.
Yeah.
Look, if you're going to make this point, I will just concede to the court, rape is a constant theme of Legion of Skanks. So I'm not denying
that. I'm on Legion of Skanks sometimes, and I get so nervous.
Yes, my point is, we're just out there doing rapey podcasts, plugging along, doing everything right. And the
saying
industry
the N-word,
but
and then not.
Anyway, before Giannis sabotaged this point, what I'm trying to say, though, is no matter what it is, it's, at this point, no. Who gives a shit about the industry? We go right to our fucking fans, dude. Like, it doesn't matter.
It's true.
Our fans listen to the podcast.
We're like Costco.
We're
the Costco of comedy.
What's up, dude?
You know what a late night set is good for?
Yeah.
To make a good tape for the internet.
Looks awesome in your bio.
You have to contact the shows. Be like, any of you guys?
And it's a checkbox, so now a club will be like, oh, okay, we can bring you.
Yeah,
because
they need that.
Because they're reactive. No one's like a fan.
They need to clip the show on the screen.
They need to clip the roll before you come.
The fans, the fucking bookers, the club owners, everybody, they're all just fucking cheap. They need to be told that you're funny. And it's just, if the booker fucking likes you for Conan or
dude, do you know how good
Colbert,
Carlos Mencia's ratings were? Carlos Mencia's ratings were fucking killing it. And then they literally had to go, no, America, he's a joke thief. See? And then they go,
oh yeah, I guess yeah, that man. Is hacky bullshit.
He still sells out clubs.
Like, but I'm just saying, it's like literally,
like one.
No, not like he got taken down quite a few.
He does bananas now.
I mean, he does still clubs though.
Yeah, but dude,
he does bananas.
He still sells.
His life is good by like our standards.
Yeah, I have three roommates.
That's the kiss of death, dude. If you get labeled as a joke thief, it's a kiss of death.
Yeah, oh, dude, we should talk about that.
We should talk about that.
We should talk about
what happened.
Talk about it. Talk about it. Talk about it. Talk about it. Guys, it's our new segment. Talk about it. White power.
What's this about?
What happened?
All right.
Somebody stole the rape a retard.
Somebody stole a rape a retard bit, and we're going after it.
How great would that meeting be, guys? We love what you do. All right, listen to a couple episodes. All right, I got.
Lewis actually had this experience of being up at Montreal last year and having like first meeting with agents, and they're just like, "Dude, we love you. We're on the verge of signing you. This looks great." And then like the second meeting, like this woman just comes in and her face is pale like a ghost, and they're like, "We googled you." And
I'm telling you, I had an agent in Montreal. I'm not naming names. Tell me, she was like, don't meet with other agents. Yeah. She was like,
boy.
You're my guy. She was like, if you meet with another agent, I'll be furious with you. I'll be angry.
Lewis, I just found the Twitter handle at Juicelayer. and evidently this is you, and you're leading a movement of Juicelayers.
I heard an agent told you, they said there's... In the intro to one of your podcasts, you said something about Jews, and they were like, can you bury that a little bit?
Yeah, yeah.
Just like bury the
because
lead.
In the intro to Legion of Skanks, it said, Smarmy Army, stand up and put your fucking Jew noses in the air.
Oh, my God.
And she goes, actually, she's like, hey, I listen to your podcast. You know, hey, you know, all the anti-Semitic stuff, it's funny. Like, I get how it's funny.
And people don't even understand the language, because when he said, Smarmy Army, put your Jew noses in the air. That was he was siding with the Jews.
Yeah,
that was like the most positive thing about Jews that Lewis ever says.
I'm sitting next to two fucking Jews as I'm saying it.
You know the industry.
Does that make it sound worse? Yeah. I'm getting kike breath all over me.
Yeah. So what were you talking about joke thievery?
Okay.
Oh yeah. Here's this story.
Okay.
Yeah.
So someone stole one of your jokes?
No.
I was
okay,
gonna
we
say.
Just put it out there.
Oh, there
no,
we go.
No, don't put it out there.
Let him do what he wants.
Just put it out there.
Let him do what he wants.
You are you telling this guy not to be a real ass dude right now?
You telling me not to be a real ass dude?
Was this
Lewis?
The dude from the stand
that we was talking?
What?
The dude from the stand the other night?
Yes.
Oh.
Can we?
So it was like a comedy adjacent person was told that someone who got new faces was a joke thief. So they did some online research and found that it was credible. So they went up and watched their new
Somebody
faces.
Got new faces pretending to be gay. And then, there's a lot of problems.
And then the set they did at New Faces was not stolen, no borrowed material at all.
Okay. But so it was all topical.
But it was all topical.
So it could have been.
So then the comedy adjacent, the comedy adjacent person was like, so what should I do now? Like,
I love he's calling him a comedy adjacent. You're an educated motherfucker.
I'm trying to like make it kind
of. Lewis would have been like, some guy who's writes on the internet.
Some faggot. Some faggot at the stand.
Fucking snake in the grass.
So he just didn't know. What, like,
what
should I do now? That's how you
sound
like. You do the impression of me. It sounds like you're fucking about to explode.
My name's Lewis Jake
on fire.
So wait a minute. So the comedy adjacent person goes and fucking comedy adjacent faggot goes and.
He's like, he doesn't know, like, journalistically, what should I do now? Should I report it? Should I not report it?
Okay, here's the deal. Here's the
fact. And the guy went and got new faces.
Here's
the got new faces.
Wrapped or unwrapped?
This is, I don't know.
Don't even worry about that much. We don't want to out the guy.
Yeah, we don't want to out the guy. Well, I don't
know. I don't know. I didn't know. This guy runs a comedy blog, and he was like, should I write about this and out this guy?
So here's the facts. Here's the facts.
It's a New York guy?
Huh? No.
No.
Here's the facts. There's four jokes. He did the jokes on TV. So he did these jokes on TV. The clips online have like hundreds of thousands of views.
Gotcha.
Yeah. The one joke was actually the full joke from the guy in Australia who stole that joke and did it on Australia's Got Talent.
No.
He did the joke that was stolen by that guy.
It's like Robin Hood.
Yeah, he stole
it. I have
it.
No problem with that.
Yeah. So one of the jokes was that joke. Hood. The other joke was...
But he stole a joke from a guy who notoriously got busted with that joke?
Yes.
Yeah. That's nuts.
Yes, that's crazy.
That's ballsy.
Yeah, it's ballsy.
Genius.
And then... I
really don't have a problem with
he's
that.
He's going to end up on Tim's podcast.
Right. Well, look, there's no reason... I don't know the guy's name, I'm not going to say the name, but I will say maybe if he did steal it, I'm being very
forgiving.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Not forgiving. I'm being very correct here.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You don't, but I'm saying if he did steal it, the shows he did were like black show. He did Shaq's stand-up show.
So All-star it's like comedy.
Those were, yeah, the jokes seem to be like jokes from like white comedians who would never that those black audiences.
That's like when you when Paul asked the real estate agent, he goes, "So how's the neighborhood?" They go, "Well, there's Shaq's All-Star Comedy right down. That's right down the block."
So it was that joke. It was a Norm MacDonald.
He did a few
line.
Bits, and they were very specific.
He did it on a television set.
He did them all on television sets. Yeah,
they were, but the jokes were very specific. It would be very difficult for these jokes to not be stolen.
There's no
for
way
it to be parallel.
The first of all, let's say this.
Two of them
that I heard, there's no way he didn't take it.
No, but this
way.
Is what I don't like, and this is what comics
Who's
do.
Who's
going to
take
it,
a Norm
McDonald's, out of fear?
You know?
Comics
right,
do
right.
it out of fear because depending on the level the person's at, they don't want they get more whispery depending on how high the person is. The bottom line is when there's smoke, there's fire. If somebody gets called out for one, that could be. But when somebody gets called out on it, they're a fucking thief, dude.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
But here's the thing.
I also
it's not a premise. Like, you can have a premise,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, like, two similar premises is fine. When you get down to the punchline.
Right. Right.
When the punchline is
word
insane.
For word.
It's also when it's a very unique.
Not even word for
it's
word.
It's a unique punchline. Because there's. Yeah. Look, I've heard people do bits that have the same punchline. It's not that crazy to people to come up with it. Any person that's somewhat clever, somewhat funny.
And I've seen
come
people
up,
choose someone where you're like, dude, you're crazy.
It's just an easy
to
joke.
Think you own that thought.
Yeah.
Like, right. That's
like there's
different.
If someone will have a very
good
generic
point. Like a lot of those Schumer jokes are really
thing.
Easy
generic.
Fucking jokes that anybody that's half a comic could come up with those
the
things.
Sketches also, weren't, though. The
yeah,
sketches
some,
were.
Some of his sketches
the
are
sketches
pretty
were dead on.
Well, I've said Kurt Metzger's a joke thief since day one, so anyway.
I think it's also indicative of, like, if...
Indicative. You motherfucker.
Sorry.
Oh. Word after word.
Travel,
tell us,
tell
us about the zeitgeist in which you're going to make your statement.
I just think that, like, if a comic comes up in a cluster of, like, peers, you check each other on that.
That's
shit.
What I said.
Well, but
I
if you're kind of coming up, like, it sounds like this kid got, like, kind of cold from, like, a really young age to, like, oh, you're, like, a teenage comic and we're going to call you along.
Well,
he's
I
not
know,
as
I,
in the scene with people who were kind of bust his balls. And
he's
like,
not a New Yorker.
Well,
LA
I know a lot.
Like, he,
I know
he, it sounds
guys,
like he's
right?
fucked up, right? But the blogger, I'm like, dude, it's not your fucking battle. And he's like, oh, I'm a journalist. I'm like, you're not a journalist.
No,
dude.
You're not a journalist.
You're in a comedy blog.
Well, dude, I'll tell you,
are,
I think
are you pretending
a lot
to be
people,
a fucking journalist right dude, now? You're not breaking a story. It's some young fucking comic.
Yeah, that nobody knows who
he
is.
You're going to ruin this kid's career.
You have no life. You go to shows, you fucking dope.
Yeah.
No, but here's the deal. I mean, joke thievery is joke thievery. This
right.
is
100%.
The reason 100%. Why it happens so rarely in our community is because
well, because
of how
we police each other.
Because of how it's policed. Now, this is a case where
not
there's
some blogger.
Four, where there's if there was one, then you're like if there was one, then you're like ah
two
right, yeah two you're still going like but
three
you start to question.
Now four would
four
happen.
It's like four
fuck that guy yeah
fuck that guy four and one of them's a Norm MacDonald.
Yeah.
Dude, how could you not? How could
and
you?
And he does the voice too.
No, how, no, he doesn't. Yeah. But this thing is like, how could you? If you know Norm MacDonald's comic, first of all, fucking Norm MacDonald is just like one of the great.
One
I fucking
right,
love
of
Norm.
Yeah.
So like a Norm MacDonald punchline is like, how can anyone who's not Norm MacDonald come up with that punchline? He has
right.
such a unique perspective on it, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. So you hear the punchline, you're like. You know, the joke in question is like a Tiger Woods joke. And like I had a Tiger Woods joke. A lot of people had Tiger Woods jokes.
Yeah. I had one.
This punchline.
It was so bad.
Was that the one? Where
tell us your Tiger Woods joke.
What was my Tiger
so
Woods
bad.
What was it, dude?
No. It's good. I bet it's good.
Oh, I go.
I bet it's great. Come on.
I was like, black people. I was like, black people get so rowdy at sporting events. You ever hear them? They're like, yeah, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, kill that motherfucker. Blah, 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 blah. And I'm like,
wait, no,
ladies and gentlemen, Tiger Woods is now teeing off.
That was the
oh
bit.
Oh boy! Where's the rag? Is the rag gone?
It's a bandana, fuckface. Bomb
tie that shit on your mouth.
Yeah.
Oh my god, that is awful.
Yeah, I said it was bad. It was one of my old jokes.
It was.
But that's the thing
horrible.
With the comedy journalism. Like there was, we went up to Montreal with a bunch of kids. One kid, a guy who writes a comedy blog, just said he didn't like the guy. He's like, that act wasn't for me. And people started flipping out, and it's like...
By the way, same comedy journalist, I think.
Yeah, but it's like nobody's reading this fucking blog. It's
yeah,
read
but
by
at the same time,
open mic.
And they're all
it's
comics.
A little bit,
who gives a shit?
It's, it's also a little bit weird, though. Like you were saying with this guy who's like, oh, should I write about him? It's like, dude, it's not like... I understand if Louis C.K.'s makes some new movie, and you're like, oh, I didn't feel like this was up to standard.
Right.
Like, you know, you're like a critic or something. When you're like saying you think someone on the level of just got new faces sucks, it's like, just save your fucking opinion.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, no one cares. You know what? You're literally just trashing another dude. It's literally like me going on Facebook and just going, you know, at Giannis Pappas.
There's no barrier of entry. I can go start fucking Luis J. Gomez comedy fucking pop and lock plug. Right. Yeah. Right. And now I'm fucking critiquing
Are you telling me you came up with a name like that and you're not going to do it?
That guy said a lot of nice things about me. But the point is, a great review. I got a great review. And you know what? You're going to deal with criticism from the New York Times and from the New Yorker and from all the... So who gives a shit? Just fucking toughen up and get over it.
And then also,
I understand. Sorry to cut you off, but I just understand. I get there being a thing when there's someone else who's, like, in this world. It's just a little bit weird. Like, I've never had this experience before, but I know friends of mine who have had, like, articles written on one of these comedy sites that are kind of shitty to them, and then, like, the guy's just hanging out at the bar, like, a few weeks later, and you're just like, oh, fuck you, dude. Fuck and, like, I get it, because it's like, what are you doing? Like, I'm grinding. You're clearly hanging around this level of comedy because you kind of like
it's
comedy.
It's like when Matt Taibbi writes something about Goldman Sachs, he doesn't go fucking hang out. You know what I mean?
Well, yeah,
The next day, be like, what's
no
up,
No one knows
everybody?
What the fuck you're talking about.
Matt Taibbi. That's not my fault.
But it's almost like if he was going after some...
It's clearly not my fault.
It's, no, you know, I mean, I'm, Tim...
You know Matt Taibbi.
Yes, I...
Great. Tim, read the room.
Yeah. I'm
but,
sorry.
But like you
it's
said,
like
but
when
said
you
Matt
get your
he
ass
was going after
by,
a bank that had like fucking $300 in total capital, and you're like, who cares?
Yeah,
what
who
are you about them?
Here's what I think should be done with the kid. When it comes to when, yeah.
What in that bedroom?
Dude, you just sounded like it was a fucking meeting that took place.
Like a committee.
Yes, right.
Here's what we should do.
Take him downstairs in a basement.
Here's what we should do. When it comes to people who are big and famous, I you can't control that it's going to come out in the way where it's like on the internet because they're so high up. So that's how it's going to... For a kid like this who's starting his career, I think I kind of agree with you now that I'm thinking about it. Like, I don't know if the guy should write the blog and put it out there.
Approach him.
It should be something, or not, it should be something now that comedians know, that some comedian has to approach this kid and be like, look, dude, maybe you did it, you were starting out, you know, you can't fucking do it again. Everyone's watching.
I will also say, like, it's not. It's kind of shitty that sometimes, like, a lot of people have a shitty experience in Montreal. Like, nothing happens, but there are a cluster of people who are like kind of like grabbed and kind of pushed through the system. And if this kid is one of those who gets grabbed and pushed through,
that's when it becomes
with stolen material.
But
there's
how stupid
someone,
how does Montreal
where,
not know about
how
any
do
of
they
this
not
shit?
Know?
How does industry how did, allow that? Look at a guy and go, well, how
because
old is he?
Because it's reactive. Like, they're not. They
it's also, you understand, 4 bits out of probably a couple hundred bits that the kid's doing.
No, he's not. Doesn't have a couple hundred bits. Are you out of your fucking mind?
What, the
fucking
kid does
David
60%.
A couple hundred bits.
A couple hundred bits.
What has he got, 18 hours of material?
What, are you out of your mind?
He's probably got tons of bangers. If he needs another one, he can borrow my Tiger Woods chair.
You fucking cocksucker.
But it is true of like...
And if that one's not available, the visor is always ready to go.
If somebody's stealing jokes
off
of the Grizzly...
Off
on. The Grizzly Pair, who gives... Like, the fuck... Who cares? But if you see them start to have success... Because Mencia was killing it.
Well, here's the thing, right?
Just
this kid, here's
it.
What this kid should be done, right? He should... this guy who writes this blog, I said, dude, there's an opportunity to write a really interesting piece about joke thievery on a smaller level up to the highest level. What?
That was just really fucking funny. I'm still laughing.
Oh, and him making fun of me? Just let it out, Jonas.
Got a lot. I like the way you referred to him as bangers. If you want, you can borrow my time.
No, but I think he should write a piece and say there is. It'd be like I know. It'd be like I didn't. And in the article, write like I'm not going to out this fucking kid because I don't want to ruin his career. But you know, this is happening even on the smallest level.
Or that guy should get a living, breathing woman and go to dinner and not write about fucking open mic level comedy who fucking gives a
that's
shit
a
no, about honest. Any
no,
of
but
this.
But you know, Ramon brings up a good point, man. It's like the guy, these jokes helped him, you know, ascend.
Yeah.
He did them on TV. So that's where I'm kind of torn, too, because I'm like, you did the jokes on TV.
On what?
I put
Hart's
it on
LOL?
I put a lot of it on the industry and the Montreal people watching.
Yeah.
Is this known?
Because
really
we're all
is.
A
like,
little
these guys
removed.
Watch, these guys watch
they're too
stand
busy
up
listening to
all
Lewis's
the fucking
podcast.
Time, dude.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They're watching it all the time. They've seen TV. The fact that they
but
can
they
just be enamored by this and then just go,
I don't think they watch it as much as you think. You know, when you sit down with agents, and you guys all know this,
know
a lot of them are just like, some chick goes like this. She's like, hey, I'm the head of comedy development. help me. And I'm like, what did you? She goes, I went to Yale with the guy's
son. Don't know what they're doing.
She's like, I've never been to a comedy
show. Oh, it'll literally be people like, I really like Adam Sandler. Yeah. What do you, like,
they're
that's
like Montreal
know
people, though?
Yeah,
no, some of them would be like, I've never been to a comedy show.
Look, Paul's definitely right that they're, if someone who's stealing jokes like this got to the festival, that's on the festival a little bit for putting them up. But I'm almost, because I don't know, like,
you're talking about the most prestigious festival in the fucking world.
Yes, no, you're right. I agree with you completely.
Yeah. But do
you
think, to get an opportunity.
To his peers, like, it must be a thing amongst them, right? Like,
that's,
I don't know.
He's not from New York or LA.
He's not from New York or LA. If he was from New York or LA, it would.
What Giannis said is right, though. Somebody should call him over without writing a blog and be like, dude, listen. I know you're young and shit, but this isn't gonna fly.
Let's call him. Let's get his number on. We'll take a break
right now.
We'll get him on the second half of the show.
Call him.
I don't have his number. We gotta get his number.
I don't even know who it is.
We gotta get a name first.
I'll tell you his name.
You guys
don't say it on the air, but call him.
No, I'm not gonna say it on the air. I gotta get out of here in a minute.
Can you sign it to us?
Tell. I mean, I'd love to have him on his show.
I gotta look it up. I gotta get out of here though. Hold on. All right. Listen, I love you guys.
All right.
I gotta plug a couple things.
Yes, guys. Lewis is now going to plug a few things.
I'm gonna plug a few.
Oh no!
I just wanted to do that.
Wait, where are you going?
He's going to Roastmasters.
Oh, I'm only really good when I'm shitting on you. So,
by the way, guys, I do host the Roastmasters every other Tuesday.
Lewis and 15% of Dave Smith are leaving.
I host the Roastmasters every other Tuesday night at the Stand NYC, standnyc.com for tickets. They're free.
Who's battling tonight?
A bunch of people. I don't have time. I gotta go.
just big time.
Check out my other podcasts, Legion of Skanks, Realize Podcast. Both available on the Gas Digital Network. GasDigitalNetwork.com.
Can I get those on Stitcher?
Also, Dave, can I just fucking do my plugs? I gotta go. Tim Dillon also has an amazing podcast called Tim Dillon Is Going to Hell this network as well.
It's great.
Check out my podcast
on the network.
Check out my SiriusXM radio show, The Countdown with Michael Bisping, every Thursday night, 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And I will be headlining comics at Mohegan Sun August 26th and 27th. So come out and have some fucking fun. It's going to be a good time, man. All right, that's it.
All right. Thanks, Lewis, for coming by. And everybody's going to go see you at the Stand. Yeah. I mean, if you're out there
tonight,
go see him at the Stand tonight. Get out of your house and go fucking see Lewis host a Roastmaster show. Is anyone sick of roast? I'm sick of roast battles. Is anybody sick of fucking roast battles? Can we say that and not get in trouble?
Why would you get in trouble?
No, you know what I mean. I mean, it's like, it's annoying that that's all anyone talks about is roast battles.
I'm sick of roast battles and people bitching on Facebook about comic movies. I like Mike Lawrence, though.
But no, it's just like, I'm not
great. I think it'll run. I think, like, everything.
And I'm not great at roast battles. That's why I probably don't like them. But hilarious. I just, I don't know. It's just something about
everything. I feel like roast battle is like the modern, like, Texas Hold'em poker. Like,
right.
It's hot right now.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
fun.
It's like, yeah, I mean, you know.
But it is.
It'll go out on its own.
In all honesty, I really loved watching Mike Lawrence win that thing. And
no,
I love watching his stuff.
Great.
I like people who are really good at it. It does bother me. I've talked about this with Lewis before. It bothers me there's a few people who roast regularly who suck at it and just get people who are good at it to write them jokes.
Right.
And it's
that's
like, you see these,
up.
This really bothers me. It's this thing where these shitty comics, and then you see them walk on stage with like this confidence of like, because they've never been on stage with like six awesome jokes to rattle off.
Yeah.
And so they feel so great, but you're like, you're literally, they'll go give five great ones and one that sucks, and you're like, oh, that one is the one they wrote themselves.
That's the one they
wrote, The other five or something.
It's
other
just weird when you
them.
See two guys who don't know each other roast each other.
Yeah, that's
you look like, or...
But that all started with the Comedy Central roast getting real popular, because it wasn't like a panel of peers, it was just like
a
panel of celebrities.
I remember Patrice said that to me before he did the one...
Charlie Sheen.
At the end, before he did
murdered
the heroes,
Charlie Sheen.
He was great, but the reason he did that one is because he really respected
Charlie
Sheen.
That's the only
Patrice
reason.
Was like on some conspiracy theory. 9/11 was an inside job shit, and so was Charlie Sheen, and that's why he respected.
He
him.
Always said
it
no
like
to
them big,
except for that.
Yes.
Like, that was the one that he would do because
but he
of
said,
Charlie Sheen.
He
which
said
is
that
cool.
point. The point Giannis was making. I remember Patrice said that where he was like, "Dude, the reason like the Dean, the old Dean roasts were amazing is because they were all like successful, great friends who were fucking ribbing each other, but they loved each other."
Right.
Now you have this dynamic where it's some like old celebrity and young hungry comedians who are just trying to like tear them apart to make a name off
that's
them.
Why the Franco
it sucks.
One
it's
that's
like
why the James Franco one was good because they were genuinely
his
friends and you could feel that they were going out that night.
Well, you know what's
and they
weird about
fun.
The ones in the city now, it's like two guys have been doing comedy a year and it's just cruel. There's no like one guy's like, you're a broke open mic, you walk dogs, you live on a floor, and then the guy goes, you fucking live on a floor too, and it's like, this is just mean.
Everybody knows shows like both these people on stage live on floors.
Why? Yeah. You know why they do it?
There's nothing redeeming about
comedy clubs are selling tickets, and the way they're doing it is they know a lot of experienced comedians don't want to waste. Like, dude, I got to be honest with you. If I'm going to write 20 jokes, it's going to be on my fucking new hour.
For your act.
It's not going to be, you know, telling, you know, Ian Bagg from Canada goes, what am I going to fucking yell at my friend for living in a one bedroom?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like, it's true. Right. It's like,
if he's living in a one bedroom, he's killing it, by the way.
Yeah. Insane. It's like, yeah, but I mean, I got to say, though, I do like that Mike Lawrence won that because I remember
he laid waste to Ralphie Mack.
No, but
that was the most amazing battle I've ever seen.
But he cared. Like, I was in the back of the stands telling him why I don't do it, why I don't like it. And he was telling me why he loves it, why he's going to do it. And then he was even getting as far as to be like, and if I go against him, he thinks that this is coming, so I'm gonna make him wait to the end. Like, he cared
that
much.
It's like a game of chess.
So he really wanted to win, and he deserved to win. And if somebody gives a fuck at that level.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I agree with Dave. It's like the stand has a bunch of no-name comedians.
Yeah.
And then, like, all these, like, celebrity experience judges, and these guys
and
don't
it's like, what are people
going
to do? Come see you roast?
Yeah.
What are people going to do? Pay, fill a theater to see you roast people? Like, what? What's the end game?
The roast one, like, when it's your friends, like, they roasted me at the Creek years
ago.
Right. And it was the funnest night.
Yeah.
We got hammered.
Good time.
We shit all over each other. But we all knew each other.
Right.
So it was like, it was more a party for us, which is what those Dean.
Right.
Well, we did that with Big J. We had a roast for him, and we had the same type of thing. Like, it was like all friends. It was love. And that was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
But the other stuff to me, I just don't. I also agree with what Paul was saying, where it's like, I've been asked by a couple of the different roast shows to do it. And it is almost like, as a comic, you feel like, it's almost like a weirdly, like, it's a lot to ask. You know, it's like you're almost used to this like balance of like, oh, can you pop by and do a few minutes? And it's like, yeah, I have an act. Yeah. I'll come do a few minutes for you. Or you do a set. It's like, okay, $75 for 15
minutes
of your time.
Is this a thing in Cleveland now?
But to just say like, can you write 10 minutes for this show is a lot.
Dude, I was at South by Southwest and they were like, hey, you know, do you want to get on another show? And I was like, what? They were like, you want to roast with Mark Norman? And I was like, no.
Right.
So I do the show and then I see Mark come in and I guess he was doing it against like Jay Larson. And he's like, dude, he's like, what the fuck did I say yes to this for? He goes, I was in my hotel room all day figuring stuff out. I don't even really know this guy's got like a
It's very stressful because you don't know if the jokes are going to work. Yeah. You've never tried them before. With your act, you keep doing it.
And you don't know
the thing.
You don't know the guy.
You know, that's the fucking thing.
People research each other.
Well, you know what the crowd...
When you don't know the guy, it's just mean. When you know the guy, it's like a love thing.
And the crowd feels that. The same way a crowd feels if a comedian's comfortable, they feel like, this guy loves
this
dude.
A friend of mine,
another comic... This guy fucking loves this dude.
Another comic brought up a good point. It's decontextualized. It's comedy for people that don't need to know anything about anything. Like, no matter how smart your act is, or how good your act is...
Thank you very much.
People in the audience, you know, yeah. I mean, but you're a good example.
I mean, I just appreciate that, you know, nice to hear once.
But you talk about religion, you talk about shit, like, you need to know something to get a joke. Something. But in a roast battle, you can walk in knowing nothing about anything. No frame of reference. You don't have to be engaged at all. And you could just sit there and go, that fat guy's fat. And it's like, oh, I get it.
The jokes are going to run out, too.
Yeah.
Your dad left, just like when your dad left. And it's like, all right.
Well,
like,
let's also be real. I mean, roasting in general, usually what works with roast writing is kind of dumbed down.
Hacky
jokes. So it's not as if, you know, it's fun, but it's like a glorified Yo Mama contest at the end of the day. It's not
100%.
Really high level. Stand up is a much more impressive,
much
more difficult thing to do.
Are they starting to do this at Cleveland?
Well,
the
comedy adjacent people are coming in.
It's like a bunch of like newer.
It depends on which adjacent person we're talking about. They're coming in.
Yeah, it's just a bunch of newer people. They asked me to do it, but I was out of town.
I got his voice already.
They have something in New York called Open Mic Fight Club, which is insane, and it's open mic comedians. One guy goes in dressed like a Klan guy and got his ass kicked.
What do they do, though? What do they do?
They just yell
one
at
guy
each
got
other.
Up.
Yeah.
One guy got up and punched him in the face.
Was
the black guy got up.
Scopo goes to these mics.
Yeah.
I don't really know, but there's a... Scopo knows
Tim firsthand. Post new faces.
Listen, I got a lot of stuff.
This guy's going to be walking home tonight.
Yeah.
Right now.
Development deal with Animal Planet. I'll tell you right now, though, it's fucking... It's crazy. This is how crazy this guy shows up at a Klan outfit and gets punched in the face, which you would imagine would happen.
Yeah.
Like, that's...
Well, because it's like, you know, it's not a room full of people who know each other. So it's
right.
Like, if you get up in a Klan outfit, that's kind of mean.
But here's the...
but for another, for it to have been another comic who
was
did
it. Was it another
yeah,
comic?
Yeah, that's the thing that just makes it, that pisses me off. It's like, it's like that dude was like bragging online about it.
Well, you
shit.
Also
you're
shouldn't
like,
do
like,
anything you're not willing to get beat up over after the show. Yeah. That's always my opinion on how to do comedy.
And there is a flip side to this.
I guess so, dude. If you want to be the guy, it just seems a little convenient to me that he picked on some tiny little white dude who didn't want to fight.
Wait
who
a minute.
Did this as a joke. There's lots of people who say racist shit in their act all the time.
Right.
Like, go fight someone who wants to fucking
no,
fight
the
back.
Fact that it's another comedian's bullshit. I agree with you. But
that is
but
bullshit.
They're the flip side to this roast thing is if you're a 3-4 year comic and you want to get in front of the booker at the stand, if you want
to
get in front
that's
of Patrick,
the way to do it.
Then you're like, they're not putting me up here on a regular set, so let me go shit on some people and show my chops at that, and then I'll get on their side. So you got to look at it
and
from that standpoint
as well. And
here's
the fucked up thing, is that you're not just getting an opportunity to go get up in front of Patrick, like the booker at the stand, like, oh, here, go do 5 minutes of your stand-up. You're getting on in this environment where I've seen people go, when it goes bad, it can go really bad, and then
horrible.
You're literally up there, you're going to be up there, you're going to bomb, then you're going to have, like, Mike Lawrence, Dan Soder, and Big J
shit
tear
on you
apart.
Rip you apart.
Patrick's going to watch you get you know, I've seen people bomb and Jeff Ross came in and watched. Let me tell you something. If you're a 3-year comic and you're trying to make it in this scene, to have Big J, Mike Lawrence, Jeff Ross, and Patrick all watch you eat a dick
is tough.
Is not good for you.
Well,
like,
let me tell
that's not what you want.
I did a Dan St. Germain roast. I bombed horribly in front of Fox, a Comedy Central, Patrick, and it sucked. But after that, it was like you do need those gut punches in comedy.
Sure,
whether they happen, it does,
I'm
you,
saying
you, need
you don't
that.
Want to fucking bomb in front of people.
I saw
who
people in Montreal go down in flames, and it's like you need that
on TV well, though too, right?
But yeah. Listen, that unwrapped
that'll
the
get
unwrapped
sweetened
up. The unwrapped New Faces show,
right?
Is like the half that crowd is like industry.
Yeah,
it's not a great crowd. There's so many industry guys there, like looking, so they're not laughers. You know,
right.
I remember I did it. Well, I was you were on the unrep show then.
No.
Rep show.
Yeah.
All right. Well,
but I was seeing no
fucking deal over here.
I was on the rep show too. So I don't know what the fuck.
I think
about.
It's funny they had to make the unrep show because everyone who's doing New Faces was already on TV and shit.
Yeah. I just. I mean, you're doing 5 minutes, right?
Well, here's the thing.
Is it five?
It's six.
Six.
But here's my thing. Listen. Comedy's a weird place now because people are more excited about roast battling. They have naked comedy shows. They have fucking underwater comedy.
That's
comedy on acid. Comedy, get fucked and do comedy. Like, jerk off one. Like, the alternative show now is just getting on stage and
you
being
gotta
funny.
You got to jerk off during your
that's
set, but at your closer, you got to come.
Like, the idea, right. Come on the fucking floor. The most alternative show is just getting on stage and
comedy
being
comedy underwater was my
funny.
Favorite.
Yeah.
It's funny.
That's what happened.
Because the
you,
improv.
You had me at comedy underwater.
The improv lab in LA started to have all these weird, like, niche shows.
Yeah.
And, like, their strongest show with the regular crowd is Comedians You Should Know, which is just a straight stand-up show.
Right.
All that's the like, other weird
so at this,
shit.
At this point,
oh,
you have to
shit.
Pitch it as a theme.
Yeah.
You're like, all right, I got this crazy theme. We book funny comics.
Right.
They all do really
listen,
well.
Listen, we're going to throw shit at them. Everybody gets a basket
I love
of objects.
I love the Creek, but I walk into Creek sometimes, and I walk in, and there's a guy dressed like an old Borscht Belt guy, and like someone's playing a piano, and like somebody else is dancing around, and there's three people in the audience. I go, what the fuck is going on?
Mm. But you know
like
what that is,
yeah.
Tim? That's all kind of reinvent the wheel. That goes away.
Yeah.
Roast battle is going
to
get old.
I have said no to every theme show. They asked me to do the naked one.
Yeah.
I did one where you used to get, remember the one where you have to get high and then get on stage?
Midnight Run.
And like, I was up there and I was so high. And I'm like, why am I doing this?
Yeah.
What's the point? Yeah. And so it was like, it's sort of anti-comedy. It's let's go fucking watch a comedian be high. It's like, dude, I don't want to be doing comedy when I'm high.
Why
are people in this room?
Yeah.
Some people can do it. For me, I don't smoke weed.
But you don't need a theme show for that. That's
just
you.
No, I just smoked the blunt like an hour before I filmed my Comedy Central special.
It's just weird, like the theme.
I like the way he threw that in right there. Nice. He was sitting on it the whole, he was like,
let him know that I got a half coming out. When is that coming out, by the way?
August 26th.
He's ready. He's ready with the date.
Oh, he's ready.
Yeah, man.
Very good. No, that's
season
good
premiere.
Congrats,
that's
by the way.
Thank
man.
You.
It's great.
Very
great.
Much.
The live podcast may be the new thing. That might be the new thing. people are into it. People like live podcasts.
Oh yeah,
I think
it's
just
great.
I think just dope podcasts is
like
who said that? Like Nate was saying it, and I remember when I did anything that you do on a podcast now on a dope one, your numbers go more than.
Well,
anything.
Dave, Dave did Joe Rogan's, and you got a big bump.
Yeah, you said you did Rogan's, and it was like more Twitter followers than.
It's pretty amazing, man. It's more. I mean, it's. I don't know what. There's definitely still some like some like prestige that goes along with getting like a Tonight Show or a Conan or something like that. But dude, doing a podcast, especially when it's something like targeted toward kind of what I do and the audience he has is into that. Yeah, dude. I mean, I got a huge bump on Twitter, my podcast,
you
all that.
You get more of a bump.
You get a
from
lot
that
of followers.
Than you will
I mean,
for
I'm
the
talking.
TV set, yeah.
I'm talking like I got like. Probably
like
4,000 or 5,000
right?
Twitter followers.
Well, because it's also easier for people to, like, if you miss the Tonight Show airing, like, maybe you'll watch it online the next day, or maybe you'll forget about
it.
You
also
like,
didn't see 6 minutes of me telling jokes. It was 3 hours of an in-depth conversation.
And
I mean,
it's
just
point of view
more
and perspective.
Yeah,
how long have you been doing your
pod?
You've been doing Adversity Effect a long time.
This December, 6 years, man.
Wow.
Okay. And what made you start doing that? Because you were, like, going on the road with Burr, I know, and stuff, and then you started doing that podcast. Like, what was that? Was that just, like, the next thing for you?
I just was like, fuck it, let me try it, and I started to do it.
Because people love your show. That's one of the ones I hear about.
No, when I go on the road, everybody's like, you got to get Legion of Skanks on there. But no, I just...
Well, that's a ginormous platform.
Yeah. No, it was just something
of
that...
Rapists.
I actually got annoyed sometimes doing
a
that.
A lot of alleged
you told
rapists.
Me, I remember you, we were talking outside the stand, and you said it was rough. You had to learn how to
it
do
took
a show.
It took me to like 45 episodes. I've done. Yeah. I just did 269th.
Wow. Jesus.
And it took me about in my 40s to be like, I have a show now. Like, I get it. I have the segments. I know how to do it. It flows, you know, getting audience involved. And then all of a sudden you tag team with other shows.
Right.
And yeah. That's how you
yeah.
You know,
I remember Giannis was doing this stuff like years ago. It was with you were
we
podcasting, number one. I mean, but
Jesus.
But you were doing the podcast, which we all really like kind of thought was a cool thing. Yeah. And then when you were doing with the characters and the videos, I remember when Giannis was doing shows and getting, and you were the one getting your own
right
audience.
Yeah, yeah.
No, whatever.
Yeah.
You did the whole
no,
thing.
No, but
in
I
Florida.
Fucked
it's
up.
Cool.
No, I fucking, Nate always reminds me of that. We were doing a podcast in 08 or 09.
Wow.
And we didn't do it right, man. We weren't consistent with it. We didn't. You know,
yeah,
and it was mostly my fault. I just didn't think that they were gonna.
You didn't know it was gonna happen.
I didn't
dude,
know
I didn't believe
happen.
In it at all. I give Lewis a lot of credit, dude. I thought it was so stupid to start doing the podcasting stuff. Bobby really believed in it, and Lewis believed in it and stuff. And literally, it's I've been doing comedy like a little over 10 years now. Is the only success that I've had is all built off podcast shit.
Yeah.
It's off Skanks, getting Rogan, getting like my podcast doing good, like others. Yeah. Literally, I've gotten nothing. I mean, I did the festival, stupid, just for laughs festival, but that didn't do much for me. I've gotten like nothing.
You
it's,
get nothing.
But now we actually have fans that come out
and
pay
to
all,
see you and fucking want to see your growth. And
the key
shit.
To all this is that in comedy, especially now where there's so many outlets, so many comedians, the key is having your own fan base.
Yeah.
That's what it comes
100%.
Down to. That's what it
and that's
is.
What you
and
have.
And being consistent
have
with the
I
show.
I have. Yeah, I have you it. Do. You know, I have it. It's, you know. It's not huge. It's
but it's there.
It's building,
I knew it was a big deal because
constantly.
I saw people, this was years ago, like snaked around Caroline's to see you, and these were guys from Long Island.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like, that's huge. You know,
you got and you got to do the podcast consistently on the time.
Consistent.
Like if they think it's going to come out on Wednesday night or Thursday, have it come out in that time all the time because those people in their cubicles are driving that long drive to work. That's when they count on it.
I think it's part of a comedian's career now. I think you have to have
a comedian without a podcast.
I mean, it's the equivalent of
mistake.
Back in the day when they're like, okay, what's your TV sitcom? What's this? What's that? It's like the thing
you
have to
you
have
have
ready.
To have either a podcast or some sort of online, like if you have a YouTube channel or
and
something.
And that's your net. That's how you keep talking to these people. Yeah. You know, it's like such a. I look at someone like Gary Veeder, right? Who's or like Sam Morrell did this year. Gary did last year. America's Got Talent, and had like a big run on that. So it's like, okay, all of a sudden he's launched into this like big show, one of the biggest shows in America, and he's like on there all the time.
It's gone.
But now he's the guy from last season's America's Got Talent. Next year he's 2 seasons ago.
Yeah.
I mean, that's like if you don't have something where you're like you're talk when you get a new fan, if they become a fan of your podcast, now they're hearing from you like every week or a few times a week or whatever it is. It's just
you put
actually
them in a
keep
fan
them
bucket.
There.
And they can't. And here's the best part: they can't take it from you. You can't be fired from your podcast. It's always yours.
Sure.
The people have to fucking hear you if they want to. That you.
So you get banned from Twitter and iTunes.
Yeah.
Well, until you do raping a retard.
You guys got banned from iTunes?
No. But people have been before. But truthfully, from what I understand, most of the time, what people have been kicked off YouTube and iTunes, it's literally stuff where they're going at. Like, don't get me wrong, I'm very anti-PC, but if you're tweeting, like die nigger at black people,
yeah,
I don't really care if you get kicked off something.
Seems,
you know what
seems
I mean?
It's appropriate.
Like, oh, okay, yeah, kick that guy off. That's fine.
And also, like, if you have a job and you're employed and you tweet that shit, you can't blame the people for firing you if you, you know, it's like...
I don't believe in the idea. There's something, like, I completely believe in free speech, but I don't believe in the idea that there's, like, no repercussions for your speech. Like, in the same way, like, if you put something out there, if you're, like, calling some 15-year-old a faggot or something like that, and then they want to be like, oh, this is, by the way, Dan who works down at, sure.
What if I'm allowed to do it?
Because then, well, then it just, it's the same thing. It kind of defines... edgy, the way that the PC police are kind of define comedy out of existence.
Yeah.
If you say I can say anything all the
time, then you
then you
the
define
way.
You define
Listen,
edgy out,
the
out of
people
existence.
People that are whose life is defined by being anti PC are insane too. Like it's two extremes. It's you have one group of people whose entire existence is about saying the word gook. You know what I mean? They're like, don't take that from me. And then there's people on the other side of it that want
live to condemn
topics
that.
To be banned.
At
they
the
don't
end
want
of
you
the day,
to
it's amazing how much they end up mirroring each other.
Right?
Like they're so similar.
Totalitarianism.
I've said this before. It pisses everybody off. But I said social justice warriors and Trump supporters are so
same
similar.
People.
Yeah. It's shocking how similar they are.
Yeah.
Like if you get one, first off, they get butt hurt so easily.
So
I mean, they're one. Your one comment that they don't like away from they're like
what's
blocked,
the dude from South Park,
you know.
Trey Parker? Is
yeah,
it, is
Matt
it, yeah.
Stone.
Yeah, he said Matt Stone and Trey Parker said the far left and the far right is the same person.
Yeah.
Literally, you can't tell them apart.
Yeah, they don't
the
listen.
Person.
They don't change.
Because they can't. They won't
evolve.
Religion.
They think both of their sides are right.
They won't evolve.
Time.
Yeah. They never go, oh, that was a good point. You never hear them go, like, oh, that was a good point. Never
it's like
thought
what,
of that.
What you said, Tim.
Yeah.
It's religious.
It's religious.
It's all like, it's like these tenets that you worship.
You can't change it.
And it's not a matter of like, oh, I actually came to this conclusion. It's just like, this is my thing.
But look, ultimately, the great thing about being a comedian, though, is I think, past all this shit, if you're consistently
funny nobody gives a shit.
Funny, it's the closest thing to sports.
Yeah.
It's not as pure as sports,
right?
But it is the closest thing because you may get passed up on something now or this or that. But ultimately, if you keep going, people will recognize that you
when
are
your
funny.
Skills evolve, people will go that it's when it gets
undeniable.
Undeniable has always
evolve,
been the word.
And you take a chance on doing something on your own, like you said, you've been doing your podcast 6 years.
Yeah.
No one made you. No one asked you to do that shit.
No,
like, you're just like, I'm going
to
do it.
He was court ordered. First he was like, no, actually, I was court ordered to do
that. I was drunk. I hit some kids.
Comedy, this scene, for as much as we bitch about the scene, and there's a lot of shit in the industry that I don't love. But, I mean, you look at other games like music. It is, dude, there are some incredibly talented musicians. I mean, like, fucking
brutal.
Incredibly talented who have nothing.
So
I mean,
hard.
Nothing.
Oh, fuck that.
It's very rare that you'd show me someone who's been doing comedy 15, 20 years who's incredibly talented who has nothing. They almost always have at least something.
Yeah.
Maybe sometimes like they should have a little bit more than they do, but it's pretty much always like they're in the game.
Yeah,
they've got something.
They're working comics.
They're making a living off this.
Which
is an
unbelievable thing.
That's the goal.
When you think about it, if you're
we take that for granted.
I mean, Scopo can tell you that right now how great that would feel.
Yeah. Exactly.
I mean, can you imagine what it would be like if you didn't have to see a garbage truck ever again?
I would fucking pray every day.
You know?
Smell of garbage is money, though.
Yeah.
And that's the most Queen statement ever. Smell of garbage is money.
Smell of garbage
that should
money.
Be when you go into Queens.
That's money.
Say
right
that.
Why you don't work? Is that what you do?
I used to work in the back of a truck, but I work for a company. Yeah.
Oh shit.
He's front office.
When did you get just comedy?
Again?
When did you get to the point where it was just comedy?
When I got rid of all these comedy adjacent people in my life.
First, you've been doing just comedy for a long time.
No, 2007. 2007 days, and I made the jump. I was
like,
broke, but I made the jump.
Probably like not working like 6 or 7 yet. 06, 07.
Okay. I'm new. I'm 6 months.
Mm. Yeah.
6 months.
Are you loving it?
Wow.
I like it a lot, but it's the last 6 months have been a lot of hard work. And there's
a lot of
trying to figure out, like, you know, what to fucking. What to do? Like
you did it right, man. You waited a little bit.
I waited,
and then you went up there and smashed.
Yeah,
it.
I waited, but now it's also like, well,
you had perspective and you had a voice.
Yeah, but I also now got to figure out like how do you organize a day, and get up and write and do the right thing.
Yeah, because you're used to like having to go to work.
Yeah,
and
dude,
be
like I fucking, you know what I mean? Like
you're gonna blossom because you have that time to think about comedy.
I go to the bakery. I spend an hour in there. and
we go for walks in Astoria.
We go for walks.
It's fantastic.
It's like we
live
the life of an old people.
Well, what's his name?
But you have to you have to decompress so your brain can.
I think there's something about that that's a big advantage. My advice usually, and I don't know, maybe this is just me pushing myself on others, but I'm always like, if you really want to do comedy, I think get out of the day job as soon as you can, even if it's premature. Quit. Yep. Go. There's something about being a full-time comic that just puts you in a mentality. That's different than when you when you're working and you have to be this phony. You realize how intensely phony a job makes you. You know all that kind of like, hey sir, how can I help? Like that's bullshit. That is not you as a person. It's
but I think
you,
it is
and
good.
And when you have to do that for so, it's nice to just be a comic and live in the like, what is my take on this?
Sure,
what's my
but I think it is good. Listen,
like,
I think it is good to get beaten up a little bit. And I look at kids who never had a day job and they came right from a liberal arts college and mommy and daddy's money.
Oh
and
no, I agree. I agree with that. I think you should work at some point in your life.
I was like,
and you got to eat. I mean, you got to balance of the two. I struggled with it for years. Like I had a day job. You got to eat. You got to survive. You got to have money. You know?
Yeah.
You were a grief counselor for 9/11.
I was
victim.
That's your standard day job.
That's
for
a crazy. Crazy
well,
job.
It wasn't a grief counsel. We were caseworkers doing disaster relief. So
that's big shit. Jesus.
We brought like people who lost family.
Giannis, they had a thing called Modern Comedian. Yeah. Giannis is one of the only modern comedians that's really good because there's a lot of shit in it. It's like it's like a mini documentary with like this crazy music. But he'll be like, I got shot. And then
it cuts to DeRozan. You know, he's like, I'm working at a new bit.
Right. Or it's like they cut to somebody who's like, somebody goes like this, I've done 15 open mics this week. And Giannis is like, yeah, the towers fell. And I went to go talk to the people. I'm like,
By the way, it was an awkward morning because the bullet just came out of my ass.
Still one of the most fascinating things to me is the Steve Renazzisi thing.
Yeah.
It's so fascinating.
Crazy.
What a, because it's not
now,
just
what's fascinating?
Up a lie.
What is the thing to you that gets you about
that? That he did it. And that he stuck to it. And
that it's so verifiable.
Right, yeah.
That's what's crazy about it. That it's you would make up. Well, I forget the exact details, but he was like, yeah, I worked for Merrill Lynch in Building 2 or something like that. And then people are like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Wait, what? That's like a thing to say. There was no Merrill Lynch in either of the buildings. You never worked for Merrill. Like, whatever. It was like all these things. There's a paper trail.
He's been good to me, and like he's so cool. He's like a friend of mine.
He's
when
Italian. Paul's like, he's Italian. He's fucking Italian.
He has some pastries.
I mean, it's just, it's a tough one because it's a big lie. I think it just, I think it just built.
It's a fucked up lie.
A
I
lot
mean, there's
of
no way
people,
you slice
no,
it.
Yeah.
It's no good.
He kept talking about it, though. Shut the fuck up.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
That's the point is, like, dude, he when you, first of all, if for fun, like, for comedians, it's not a lot that makes us laugh.
Yeah.
You know, we got to see, like, a puppy killed or
something.
Yeah, something good.
We're dead inside.
Hold on. You gave me a visual. All right, man. Keep going.
But, like, going back and listening to his Marin is fucking hilarious, knowing
that it's all bullshit.
Oh, he did a whole episode on it?
And he goes into details about getting out of the town.
No!
Is it hilarious?
Dude, it is. It's on another level because you have the knowledge that the whole story is bullshit. He's like, yeah, smoke was over here. We're looking for a fire cake, you know. He's like,
it's crazy.
Tells the whole story in detail of how he got
out.
Now, what do you think, what should happen to a guy like that?
That's a sociopath.
I think exactly what happened.
That's exactly what happened to him, just bombing
everyone,
a roast battle.
Yeah. You should have to bomb a roast battle. That should be your...
Oh, was it bad?
It was bad.
Yeah, it was bad. He
tried to get out
of
a rape
joke
out. He couldn't even do it. He's like...
That was really bad. By the way, I think there were people
Moral
who
had
reacted.
A great line. He goes from 1 to 10, I give that a grand zero.
Yeah.
That was a great
line. That was like the line.
People got... When the lie first came out, there are some of these people who are like... Their reaction was almost like, he should be, you know, he should be hung. And you're almost like, all right, relax.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
He didn't hurt anybody. He didn't. Yeah. It's just a very strange thing to make up.
And it's
like we've all made up lies, but that's a really odd
I love
lie.
Lying. I love liars, but that's
you,
a rough
yeah, because you can't get around the fact that it's offensive to the people who it's lost
thousands
people
of people.
There.
But nothing is funnier than somebody lying in your face when you know it's a lie.
I think lying is hilarious.
I love it. It's my favorite thing.
It's fucking hilarious.
Go listen to it.
It's,
you'll find joy in it.
It's so foreign to like me. Like I can't. I just can't. I can't live like that.
Yeah,
the guilt and shit. But the fact that somebody could just tell your story. Yeah, this happened. It's fucking hilarious. It's fucking hilarious.
I think that.
So Steve comes in. We call him 9/11 Steve.
Yeah.
And.
But you know what it is, man. Like I do think it's kind of indicative of the times a little bit. You see that comedy
we're talking about roast. We're talking about all these theme comedy and diversity. Comedy and being funny has become like the third, the third most important thing as far as the industry is concerned.
Right, being funny is not number one at all.
When the industry looks
followers,
at you,
followers are the biggest one.
No, the biggest thing is like they look at you and it's money. Okay. So they're looking at you like, do you represent a coveted demographic? Do you mirror a coveted? Are you young? Are you? We're trying to get this growing Latino. I mean, I work for a network that its whole business model was trying to capitalize on the dollars of the growing boom, first and second generation Latin Americans. A whole fucking network. You're talking about Disney and Univision put millions, hundreds of millions of dollars into the network.
First and second generation
to try
rapists,
to capitalize. To be fair. So it's like things now are kind of gauged at, like, is he Latin? Is he a woman? Can he speak to the woman demographic?
Yeah.
Is he a woman?
It's things like that. So with Steve Renazzisi, it's like he had this story
that
made him unique, and he used it.
And also, it's like you said, everyone loves kind of a victim story. So if there's ever a thing like, I lived through it, or we love to celebrate someone's tough day.
He's not just
whatever,
a white guy. He's a white guy that fucking sprinted out of Tower 2.
I'll be honest, I wish I kind of knew it earlier. I didn't talk about getting shot till I did that Modern Comedian.
Yeah.
I didn't talk about it on stage ever until he wanted to do it on that. Man, I never talked about 9/11.
Second Amendment rallies and shit.
I could have fucking, or just.
I forgot Giannis had gotten shot, and I sent him a clip. I was on Fox News' Red Eye, and I thought, and I forgot what I even said on the thing. I thought, oh, Giannis would be excited. Because I got a stupid TV thing because he put me on his show like years ago. And I forgot it was me defending gun ownership. And the whole clip was like, yeah, fuck these people. Everyone should have a gun. And I sent it to Giannis. I'm like, isn't this hilarious? And he writes back. He's like, not really, no.
Did
and
I
I'm
really?
Like, oh, yeah. And I'm like, oh. And
I
then
didn't
I remembered.
Say that.
Yeah, I think he just said something like that. And
of course you did. He remembers it vividly.
No,
exactly. I think you did. He's fucking resenting
well,
you for years.
For? Fucking no, Steve Renazzisi of YKW.
I said, listen. No, but I said, fucking. I was like, isn't this hilarious? Oh, because it was The Daily Show. The Daily Show used a clip of me saying something about guns, like Obama not crying about certain things and Obama not caring about gun violence. And I said to Giannis, and Giannis kind of wrote back. He was just like, yeah, great that you're getting TV time, but like, you know. He's like, he said something about guns. He's like, I know Americans don't want the toys of death taken away or something like that. Like, we can't take our toys.
No. I think you were making fun of Obama for crying, right?
Yeah,
which I thought was.
I was being a puss about that whole Sandy Hook thing.
Get
over it, you little girl.
Saying. Let me say this about the people who are pro-gun. They have this fucking, like. They have that thing where they don't listen to your argument. They just think it's you're against guns.
Right.
That's not what gun control is about.
Right.
Like.
Yeah, but that's on both sides, dude. That's gun. There's a lot of gun control people I know who are like that.
I'm sure there is.
And you correct like the thing they said, and then they repeat that same thing two points later, and you're kind of like,
I'm sure there is. But it's like the point is it's about regulating. It's about regulating something that can cause mass destruction quickly. That has done that, you know. That's what it's about. That's what it is. And it's like everyone always shouts that fucking Chicago example, which is my favorite because nobody ever goes into depth about what that Chicago. Because the Chicago example is actually the best example for gun control, universal. Because the reason why there's so many guns on the street in Chicago is because the laws are so lax in Indiana and neighboring fucking where they go to gun shows and
but
buy them
listen,
in bulk and then sell them on
the
line.
But doesn't that make the argument more or less, I don't want to get too dragged into this, but doesn't make the argument that basically then they'll still come in from Mexico? Mexico is essentially going to be our unregulated
not with that wall.
That's right.
Well, that's right.
There's a good point of now you're going to have that type of policy.
Well, America runs around selling guns to other countries.
Look,
so
dude,
I think
to just say the problem in Chicago is that there's lax laws
crazy.
In Indiana.
That's not
a
true.
Place in Indiana where you don't see any of this violent crime happening. Look, I was in Chicago a couple weeks ago. Even when you go to Chicago, okay, the violence is still over there. It's not like you go to Chicago and the violence is right here. It's this little tiny corner of the south side of Chicago, and that's where all these gun deaths are happening. And when you go to the fucking north side or fucking west Chicago, it's nice, and nobody's dying there. There's a lot of problems going going on.
There's a lot of issues,
cultural
social
problems,
issues,
prohibitions
right.
of drugs, gang-related problems. There's a ton of shit going on. But the truth is, these same lax gun laws that you're complaining about exist for all these other cultures where the people aren't killing themselves. Look, I say the thing to look at is repeal of prohibition. Dude, we had a crazy gang violence murder problem in this country when we had prohibition. We repealed it. It all went away. Legalize drugs. You get rid of 70-80% of this fucking gang violence. Go away.
Well, that's true. And there's cultural elements to it and everything like that. But a ban on assault weapons and a background check
has nothing
check
to do with Chicago, dude.
Huh?
Nobody dies in Chicago of fucking AR-15s.
No.
It's all handguns out
no,
there.
No, but they do die because the guns get on the street in poor neighborhoods where there's a lot of crime and drug violence. So
illegally, though. There's already laws against that. None of those fucking people have guns legally.
Yeah, but it is a poor neighborhood, and that's why the guns are so high in demand over there. The guns aren't high in demand in the suburbs of Chicago because it's a safe neighborhood. The police protect that neighborhood.
Well, I mean, look, in Texas, it's fairly safe, and there's high demand for guns. People want them.
I don't think it's as cut and dry as anything. I think if you enforce the gun laws, and I don't think, and it's also, listen.
Were you a gun guy, Tim? Do you own guns?
I don't own guns. I should. If somebody looks like me and sounds like they shouldn't, but I am a red flag. I'm a walking red flag, you know? I'm like, Trump's got ideas. They're like, all right, thanks for coming. But no, here's the deal. I think that if you look at it and you go, but there's also people, and I'm a guy like you, I agree with a lot of what you said, but when somebody goes, hey, how about a background check for 3 days at a gun show or online, and somebody goes, no, that takes away my rights.
Most gun owners support background checks.
So,
and a good
I don't understand
support
how you
assault weapons bans.
Right.
I don't
and
understand
that's what
can
I'm for. That's universal background checks.
If you're paranoid
checks
about the government, you think that the government's going to put you on a list.
Right.
And that you, when you go to overthrow said
government. Because it's always worst case scenario.
Yeah.
It's always worse.
Right.
Look, there
right
will always be gun violence. They will. Yeah, people who are motivated enough will get fucking guns illegally. You know? But it's like.
Right, look, I mean, you see what's going to happen in Nice. I mean, people will take a fucking truck
it'll
into
happen
a crowd of people. I mean, you see it in the Boston bombings.
But that's the extremist example.
Yeah. Extreme.
But that's but it does seem to me that those are the same people who you make the argument for banning AR-15s against. I mean, look, banning these AR-15s, the truth is that most of the time, you're talking about these mass shootings, they're people who pass background checks, who plot this out for a long time. Those people,
are
hard to stop.
The government is using to do that. You know, it's all kinds of things.
No,
whatever it is.
You got to get into the specifics of each person who did it. I think there's a lot of good evidence that a lot of those kids who got those guns should not have been able to get those guns.
Of course not.
Especially
one of those kids
was
on the FBI
shouldn't
list like three times.
I mean,
fucking kids?
Yeah, but you got to think something. Okay, but
Arizona kid.
Paul was like, damn, the FBI list, these fucking kids. These fucking kids on the FBI list. When I grew up, you were on a fucking FBI list.
I mean, come on.
Jesus Christ.
That kid in Arizona.
Sunday dinner.
The kid in Arizona had no fucking eyebrows.
I tried to
like
a Walmart.
He does a great Paul Verzi.
He's got to do it. I'm afraid to do it. It's not that great.
It's fucking fantastic.
It's not that
good. Come on.
Go ahead, do it.
It's not that good.
Come on. You know it is. You know it's perfect, too.
I got to hear it. You know who did a good one the other night was Dan Soder.
Let me tell you, I've been doing a podcast since 1994. There were no podcasts. I did a podcast
that is
nine
a good one
years.
That is a good one.
I had one listener. Wow. You know who it was?
Yeah.
Me. It was me. The other night I opened for Bill Burr. There were 1 billion people. They were in a stadium. And there were animals. Animals came to watch us. Seals. And they came with their
families. Do I whisper?
That is good.
No, because every time I talk to Paul, he's standing outside the stand. He's smoking a cigar.
Dude, that is a good impression.
And he's blowing smoke into the sky.
When you're doing that.
Oh, like, how do I know? And he says, no, but he gives me good advice. Like, we'll be outside the stand. He's smoking a cigar, and he's always blowing air. And he's like, you know what it comes down to? I like you. You don't have a thing. You don't go on with a Superman shirt. All these fucking kids, they got Superman shirts. They're male feminists. I don't know. Does that kid really have cancer?
So I get low when I go in?
It's more like an on-stage voice.
Right. Yeah. It's kind of like an essence thing.
Do the perfect joke. Yeah, the perfect joke.
Sometimes I tell the audience, because sometimes I do the perfect joke. And if they don't laugh at it, I say, hey, fuck you.
That's great. Dan Soder did a good one too.
Soder's great.
Bobby's is terrible. Bobby just goes, Dad, you know, he does himself.
Bobby does him in a higher voice. Him in a higher voice.
Yeah, what the fuck? It's like, that's you, dude. I drink four waters. How about that? Huh?
Both of you are fucking killing it. Yeah. You know, it's hot in here. This AC is not as good as
you
used to be.
You know, it was funny when Lewis told me, you know, book me for this or whatever. He was like, all right, you, Tim, and Dave are all going to be, just please no politics. It's like, dude, we had to do one. We had to do one.
I'll sit down with you, but look it. Don't make my head hurt.
Don't fucking bring up book shit.
Don't bring up
podcast.
None of your book fag shit.
I think
I believe in freedom and Giannis is a commie, but we can agree to disagree.
I said to Giannis in him. I looked up the message and I actually wrote to Giannis.
Yeah,
said,
what is it?
I this is exactly what happened. I sent him the thing and then I said, which was funny. This is what I write. So I go, hey, you may find this funny. He's like, good to see you on TV. I wouldn't use funny is what I find it. And he goes, I didn't cry after any of these shootings and nobody cares. He goes, he's being sarcastic. He goes, I really do think it's the most important thing to critique, however, that he cried, that is. And then
I got fucking.
Then he goes like this. Yeah. So then he goes, I felt bad, and I was like, I thought Giannis think it was cool. Then he writes that. So he's like, yeah. He's like, you can't take away our favorite toy. We're grown adults. If you want to get murdered by them, that's our fucking business. So this is what I wrote. I wrote, well, I know you've been shot. I can't really win this argument, but I'm glad you didn't die, and I enjoyed Bar 4 immensely. Great show. And he wrote back, that was
great.
Funny.
Yeah, that was good. That, you know, it was funny. Yeah, we were both being sarcastic.
We were being funny.
Yeah, but you went a little.
I went a little deep on that.
Yeah, that was a little deep.
I got to admit that was a little uncalled for.
No, but listen, you have been shot. I have no right to fucking, you know what I mean? I have not been shot.
Well,
what's the closest?
I will get shot.
What's the closest feeling to being shot, like you've had since then or before
then?
Dude,
it is such a helpless. Like, you know, it's so unfair. Like, you can't. It's so daunting when someone points a gun at you. You're helpless. Look, here's the thing about the guns. It does depend who owns the gun. You know what I mean? The gun itself.
The wider, the better.
Is not the problem. Assault weapons and like sniper rifles. Those aren't defense weapons. You know, it's a fucking assault rifle. It's a weapon of war. The more people that have that, then what's the difference between a civilian location and a battleground? If everyone's walking around open carry with fucking, you know, it's about putting, you know, just being sort of reasonable and understanding that this is a dangerous thing. Like, you know, like prescription drugs are regulated, things like that. Yeah. And you say, oh, well, people will always get oxy. Yeah, but it's not about stopping people from, it's kind of trying to curtail the problem as much as you can. Otherwise, what's the point of any laws? You know what I mean? What's the point? People are always going to murder. Yeah. People are always going to shoot. It's going to fucking happen. And then people say, oh, they're going to run over you with a truck. Yeah, but it's going to happen.
And it's
you
weird.
Can't ban trucks, but here's the difference between trucks and guns. Trucks, you
have
can
a registration.
You have to do all that shit. That's one point. Insurance. But the more point is, like, trucks have a function in society other than killing people. You can't ban trucks. You can't ban knives because what the fuck are you going to slice your chicken with? Crazy people are going to do crazy shit. But what you can't do with a knife easily, you can still do it, is like kill 20 kids in fucking a couple of minutes.
Yeah, but guns also serve other purposes for protection, hunting, sports,
and those are
like
great.
That.
And I'm for that, dude.
And
I'm not anti-gun.
So there are lots of like, and in fact, there's lots of data on this that you can look up. But guns actually do prevent data. Guns do prevent a tremendous amount of crime. The thing is, you can't measure it as easily as you can the gun deaths. But guns prevent a lot of crime. You can go look at there's this one Department of Justice stat.
And that's great. But you see, that's not my argument.
Right.
You see that the people always against what I'm saying always
change. No, I'm responding directly to what you were saying when you're saying there's not these other uses for it, like a car has other uses. I'm saying there are positive uses
for
guns.
No, killing
like,
people. Stop it. Killing someone.
No, but it's not just killing someone. Say someone like having armed security at a venue might actually de-escalate any violence that would have happened. So this is the thing that gun control advocates don't like really wrap up.
But it only de-escalates because other people have guns. So so it's like you need a gun.
But the fact that some other would-be guy with a gun sees they have armed security and goes, fuck, not going to shoot anybody up tonight, not going to start a fist fight, not going to pull my knife out.
First, you want a gun, you seem like a guy that owns a gun.
This is podcast part two that just happened. You know
what? My head's hurting, I'll tell you that right now.
Well, Lewis
might have been right.
We shared a gun.
I have a lot of land, and I got big animals.
Right, you got deer.
I got deer, and I got sometimes there's like rabid fucking coyotes.
Right.
So I wanted something, but my wife was like,
rabid coyotes?
There was one, everywhere, man.
Okay.
So
the wife was like,
my wife was like, you got kids, your son's into action movies, so I wanted to get a dog. And not, you know, he's not a guard dog. So, so the whole thing is,
what you
know,
got? What kind of dog?
Like,
you
that's
have.
Like my bit. I should have got a gun. He's a rescue. He's an island dog from Aruba.
Okay.
And he's awesome, but he's a wild. Like
an
island
dog from Aruba. He's just fucking hanging
just
out.
Just smoking
doing
pot.
Calypso. Yeah. Hey man, I'm with Verzi now.
I would have a gun.
Yeah,
you know, I would.
Sure.
If I lived in the country, I would have a fucking gun.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I grew up with a. I grew up like around guns. Yeah. I saw guns and it was responsible.
I would own a favorite, gun now. One of my favorite jokes you have is like, I forget the first part of it, but the second part of it is like, you walk down the street at Bushwick Avenue, you get punched at 3 o'clock in the morning, you're like, oh, Trump's got some good points. Like, well, it depends on where what your experience is like that day.
It's totally yeah, what yeah, your yeah. experience is.
That fucking day, absolutely.
We're all self-interested pieces.
At the
of
end
shit.
Of the day, you got to try to keep, the goal is, and I think what you're saying is, trying to keep guns away from unstable, yeah, yeah. Mentally unstable. Mentally unstable people should not be able to go get. I mean, I don't think anybody could argue.
No, I agree. Yeah. But it's also like it should be like, well, kept in mind that we are safer than humans have ever been in history. Like violent crime is at a 30-year low. It's like they show you all this crazy shit on the news,
right?
But we're actually just the most pussified, safest generation ever.
Well, that's
there's
what Obama
never
said.
Been a safer.
But we do have the most safer. Like. Mass shootings.
Well,
where, like,
give Europe a chance. They're catching up.
Yeah, they're catching up.
They're doing everything they can.
We do have a lot of roast battles. We have an outbreak of roast battles happening. Nobody is safe from the zinger. It's, you know,
you're going to get a gun, Tim?
No, I don't think I'm going to get a gun. You know, maybe the sour cream gun at Taco Bell. You seen that? You seen that gun? The way they shoot sour cream on a chalupa?
I think it just sprays.
Yeah, No, I mean, I'm not a gun dude. It has nothing. I've never wanted.
Can
I don't
you
care.
Imagine if everyone was armed in New York City getting on the train?
No, it'd be ridiculous,
dude. A fucking simple like fight would turn would end like a Quentin Tarantino
right,
movie.
Right.
But I agree with you. Look, at the end of the day, like I'm a Second Amendment guy, but I'm a New York Jew. I've never owned a gun in my life. I can't really wrap my head around how people in Texas have the gun ownership rate they have.
That's their culture.
And that's just
they're
that. But that's
outlaws.
The thing is that
that's
it is a different
do.
Culture,
yeah.
And I'm just very humble when I
that's
go
the thing
after
about
that.
America.
Because the truth is, lots of different cultures live with guns all over the
people
place,
don't
and there isn't violent,
there's
high violent
shooting
crime rate.
Raccoons and eating them for dinner.
It's,
this
a, it's
country
a weird country,
is,
man.
Is, you know what I mean? Like, there's 50.
No, there are. You are right. There are other factors. There's. Look, there's other factors involved in it, you know?
Yeah.
But when you look at some of the stuff like open carry assault rifles and lack of gun show loopholes where you could just go in and fucking buy whatever, nobody asks any questions and things like that, and how they're different by state to state, it's not hard to see how you could just the flow of guns could
no,
go.
No, I'm with you.
What about
but
the
a lot
dude
of
on the couch? What do you think about guns? Would he give him the mic? This guy's been sitting here the whole time.
This is Doug.
Yeah, Doug.
Who is
introduce
this guy?
Yourself.
We never introduced him.
Doug looks like every mass shooter for the last 5 years.
He's the guy that stole the jokes on New Faces.
Yeah, he's the guy that stole the jokes on New Faces. So I feel like we should give Doug a chance to say something.
He looks like Nick Cody. Doesn't he a little bit?
Not really.
All right.
Not Australian either.
No,
I'm just a fan. This is the second time I've sat in.
Oh, cool.
This is awesome. Thank you for having
me. Be honest. You're just here to look at Lauren.
Yeah, right.
I want to hear this couple of comics screaming.
You got a gun, Doug? You got a gun?
Yeah, I have a couple.
He's like, one in my pants.
I'd like to see Obama try to take it.
What kind of guns you got? You have any guns, Ramon?
Nah, man. I got weed.
That's good.
And adjacent stuff.
You're a shotgun.
I love the comedy adjacent. I'm taking that with me for my lifetime.
Sure, man.
Yeah, that's I be love on interviews you hear next week.
Comedy somebody tries to say something to me in English. I'm like, you're comedy adjacent, man. I don't talk. I don't really fucks with people who are comedy adjacent.
I don't, man.
By the way, I had to tell you this. Blazer Ramon is one of the dopest fucking Twitter feeds ever.
Oh, thanks, man.
Yeah, that was my
cool
wrestler.
Name.
That was my wrestler too back in the day. Scott Hall, right?
Blazer Ramon was a lot of fun.
Yeah. Is
then he
alive?
Became a
Scott
weird heroin addict.
He's alive, right?
Razor Ramon's still alive, yeah.
I saw the documentary about Jake the Snake. Amazing.
How
you
fucking
so
great
bro.
Was that, dude?
Dude, I hung with Jake the Snake
Let
for
me tell
a little
you,
bit.
Amazing.
He's a
doing
cool guy.
Comedy now.
Yeah, I did a
dude,
show with him.
Of course he is. Why wouldn't it? You know what I mean? I feel like pro wrestlers, comedians, there is like a similarity there. Just a despair
a
and hopelessness.
Yeah, that we're fucking in Best Westerns.
Yeah.
Limping to our hotel room at a Best Western.
What a great doc.
Yeah, that was a good one.
The great show, you know, that was sad.
That
was,
dude, that
wrestlers are comedians that put themselves through fucking hell. Like, we don't have to do that at least.
Nobody thought Hulk Hogan would like own Gawker. You know what I mean? Because of a fucking sex tape.
Yeah,
that's amazing.
Jesus.
Never thought I'd watch Hulk Hogan bang some other dude's
Did
wife
you?
For
right,
5 minutes.
Right.
And then
did you?
Yeah, was it, you didn't watch the video?
Nah, I don't like shit like that.
Dude, it's like the most awkward sex tape I've ever seen in my life, too. Yeah. It's like he's like banging him for like 3 minutes, and then he's like, oh, I think I'm going to fart. Yeah. Like, it's like a weird.
No, he didn't say that.
He's not even kind of hot.
Did he say that?
No, but he starts going like, oh, I feel so bloated at one point. Like, he really did.
It's disgusting.
Like,
it is a weird.
It was rough.
He makes noises, like old man noises.
Like, oh, why did they eat turkey right before this?
Right.
Did he spray
paint? His son, didn't he kill somebody in like an accident?
Yeah, car accident.
Yeah,
right?
They got sued for a lot of money, too.
Drunk driving, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Man, the Hogans. It's a rough.
So, Tim, do you use the word faggot or no?
He calls me a fag every other day.
I mean, sometimes with Scopa. I don't use it on stage.
Sometimes with Scopa.
Sometimes
he
told me
stop being a faggot.
No, but in all seriousness, are you offended by it?
No, I don't care. I think if you use it offensively, you can use it offensively. You know, I don't say it on stage. I got maybe one joke about being gay, maybe two jokes, and that's it. And then the rest of it is screaming about Saudis. Because I feel like it's more interesting and funner. But I don't use it. I don't have a problem with it. Like, you know, there are dudes who make it funny. That's the thing. If you use a word like that, the emphasis is you have to make it really funny.
Yeah.
That's
absolutely.
The thing with that. Louis did it. Louis used the N-word and made it really funny. Like, I would never do that because I don't know. I don't even know. I'm nowhere near good enough to make that word funny, and maybe I never will be.
It's got to just come to you. It's like the way any joke you think of, if it comes to you, like if something really funny comes to you, if it's funny enough, that's like the beautiful, natural ebb and flow of comedy, is that if you're going to say something really offensive, like you get this natural balance that then the punch has to be that strong.
Right.
Or I think it's true if you get too serious on a topic, like you could get really serious in a joke, but then the coming punchline has to get hit hard enough to justify
every audience
that.
Is all the different. Tension you built. Yeah. You know, every group of people is different, and that's the great thing about comedy is like, there's going to be a group of people, if everything goes the right way, there'll be a group of people that really dig and get what you're doing. Yeah. And it doesn't have to be everybody. Like, might not be the world. You know what I mean? Like,
no, but you're right, too. If you have a funny rape joke, it's got to be a monster. It's got to be a monster. It's got to be brilliant.
If you're going after, if you're doing a retarded kid joke, like, that's the one that
I call
like,
them slow babies.
Yeah, it's got to be good.
Attell's bit on his new thing was brilliant. Yeah. It was so funny, the fucking special needs bit he did.
It's got to be good.
It's
got to
be good. And that's in the comedies you get every night. You do it, you're getting feedback. That's a great thing about this art form as opposed to, like, other. It's like you could.
But that's why these social justice warriors are fucking retarded and don't understand comedy at all. Because they'll be like, these guys are getting away with rape jokes.
But like Bill
Burr said,
just ignore
them. If the joke is that harsh, it's not going to do well, dude. It's like if there's no punch to it.
Right.
And if it's an inhuman joke.
You
got to
just ignore them.
Right.
You actually have to go harder.
Yeah.
You actually not only ignore them, go harder and don't apologize. But too many comics are afraid
of losing
money.
That's the thing, is you can't apologize.
Because
that's the worst thing you could do.
They're afraid of losing shit.
But you notice the ones who didn't apologize, the story completely went away. You remember
goes away.
Natasha Leggero? She said, I'm not apologizing.
Yeah.
That was the best. She said something about veterans, and then the story was fucking done. It's when you apologize. But you know what? Tosh apologized because fucking Viacom probably leaned on him.
I opened for Joe Coy in Chicago in 2011 when he said faggot on stage, and like he wound up getting like fired from Chelsea Handler pilot, like lost it, like his manager let him go, and like it was like a crazy spin.
That's crazy.
Because like it went from like,
but if you're on Chelsea Handler,
yeah,
you gotta know that that's kind of their,
it went from like the dude's blog wrote, he's like, I enjoyed the show, but he said faggot on stage, and then Huffington Post picked it up the next day.
It wasn't even bad, right?
Yeah, it wasn't like his zipper was down for like the first 20 minutes of his set, and someone noticed, and he's like, oh, has it been down the whole time? And some guy was like, yeah, I saw it, and he's like, oh, what are you looking at my dick for? Were you a faggot? Offhand, the same way, like if someone stands up in the front row and you're like, oh, are you going to shit? Like, it's not.
Did he get a laugh?
It got a laugh, and then it was just literally in the middle of set, like
just
nothing.
Stupid. Yeah.
Huffington Post picked it up and said, like, this is after reports he said a rant similar to Tracy Morgan's on stage at a college and got booed off
stage.
Tracy
got forced,
you know what it is, too?
NBC.
There's so much media and so many, like, nobody works a real job in this country.
Nope.
Nobody. Nobody.
So everyone's trying to get hits on their blog and shit.
Go to Williamsburg, ask those fuckers,
I'm
what
not
are you doing?
Mention
they stare
the name.
At you.
I'm not going to mention the name, but this thing really got me fucking twisted, is this fucking article on CNN about this, like, it's kind of like a joke blog about how it would be great if Michael Phelps passed the flag carrying responsibilities to that Muslim African-American fencer.
Oh,
Yeah. Right.
It's like, you know, you're just giving Trump supporters their wings when you say dumb shit like that.
Right.
I mean, he's like, this is athletics. This is he was.
What Bell did?
Yeah. Oh, there you go.
Yeah. No,
I like the guy. I do like.
What happened?
But the article was just fucking.
I'm glad you brought that up because I actually said this guy needs to shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
I don't get it. What was listen, he saying? I don't know him, and I actually have friends. My friend Joe Bartnick knows him from San Francisco. He's a nice guy.
He is a nice guy.
But you know what? That aside, and I didn't want to talk bad about a comedian, but the fact that this guy is going, he should have Michael Phelps. And here's the funny thing. It's not because he's the most decorated Olympian ever.
He's the biggest Olympian. He's the most decorated. You want to carry your fucking flag?
But not only that,
and he's
a going
productive
back.
Stoner.
And he's,
right.
Yeah, but and that's funny that you say that because he went to rehab and wasn't going to go back. Then he decides he's going to go to his fifth Olympic Games, which is a record, and they make him captain of the swim team. Who else? And
but I think there are comedians out there that want to affect change more than they want to do.
And here's what he's doing. He's also
saying
that he shouldn't, Michael Phelps, in this way, haven't white guys enough? Haven't there been enough white guys? Haven't you guys had enough? Why not pass it over? And I know he's doing it for his show or whatever, but it's enraging. Yeah. It's enraging because one has nothing to do with the other. It's ridiculous.
I think I think Giannis is really right. And this is why I know there's a lot of like liberal friends of mine who aren't like, you know, crazy social justice warrior people who are like, they realize this is what's leading to Trump and all those people. You want to keep like kind of like shaming. You want to basically, if your answer to the last 200 years of racism is to now be racist against white people and look for the excuse to bash white people constantly, it's like, okay, your average, like, whatever the IQ of the average Trump supporter who's out there at a rally is, that person who's not like this fucking genius, who doesn't have a... People like to think of their own group as good. It's a very natural human tendency to be like, my uncle made the best chili, my family is the best at this, our local restaurant is the best. They want their team to win. And if you keep fucking raking people over the coals, like, your team is bad. White people did bad throughout history. Eventually, they just want someone who stands up, who's like, our team rocks.
It's feeding into the Trump supporters.
Team. Our team's cool.
Totally. And here's the thing about it. It's like, it serves his purpose. It's like, she's wearing a hijab, so that would be like a good thing.
Right.
But it's like, look, the hijab, if we want to talk about it, means a lot of different things to a lot of different people, man.
It's not fun to the women in Iran or have
exactly,
to wear them.
Exactly, dude. Yeah. Like, I understand some people see it as
well, guys like W. Kamau Bell unwittingly start doing the bidding of fascists and tyrants.
Well, that's what's interesting.
And that's what liberals do. And, I mean, I don't want to get on a thing here, but the reality is that when he starts saying things like that, like, oh, it'd be good, it showcases diversity, it's like, yeah, maybe and maybe not. The reality is that there's a lot of people who don't want to wear that garment, you know?
It's the Olympics.
And it's kind of irrelevant to her. She's a fucking fencer. You know, she's a fucking fencer.
It's the first time.
She can have a fucking birthday hat on her
By the way,
as long as she wins fun for the US of A.
But this is the crazy thing. This is what I was saying about comedy before, where it's been overrepresented by blacks and Jews. It's bringing this victimhood to an area that doesn't need it.
Right.
The Olympics?
Yeah, go
are
talk
you
about
fucking
Goldman
kidding
Sachs.
Me? The greatest,
talk about Wall Street.
But I'm saying
the greatest
Olympic moment in modern history was Muhammad Ali carrying that torch out in 96.
Right.
Like, the Olympics? What do you think? There hasn't been black athletes represented in the
yeah.
I mean, are you out of your mind? What is sprinting? What is all of track and field?
Yeah.
The NBA players aren't even staying in the players' village,
they
stand
have
on
their own
yacht
boat.
Because they are multi-million-dollar properties that move around like Nike's. Like, Carmelo Anthony's going where? No.
Right.
He's like, what are you talking about? It's just like inserting victimhood into
it's
nonsense.
Doesn't need it. Yeah.
It was, and he got the backlash, and you know, it's like. You post
but sometimes that's what people want. Listen,
no,
that's what I love.
That. He wanted
and I
that.
Like I like Ann, but Ann Coulter, and I try to get her to do my podcast. This is somebody who just wants to throw acid around.
Yeah.
Like, that's what Ann wants to do.
She's doing, man.
But
she knows what she's doing. She's selling books.
She's selling
and
books.
And this guy's
like,
got a show, and he wants people to. Yeah.
She want
to
fucking.
Yeah, but
backlash.
Those people have fucking low moral character. That they're only saying it to for their own.
No.
But
they're
the same. They're the same person.
Listen,
just different sides.
It's not
same,
the betterment of society. Like,
no, but they don't want that.
Like, they don't care about that.
No, but you could tell. Like, the difference when we talk, we're talking. You know, I might say I didn't think about that way. You may say I didn't think about it that.
Right.
You know, we're trying to figure out what the problem is. Those people are out there going trying to.
Well, we're also on Bobby's.
podcast.
They've also got better careers than we do. They have a lot better careers.
You know, that's a big problem in this country. Yeah, it's true. Fucking op-ed kind of pointing. Like, it's for their own self-aggrandizement. It's, it's not a dialectic about let's figure out what the truth is.
Well, it's amazing how much that team mentality shit. Like, I do a lot of shows at Fox News, and it's amazing how much when you get there, you're just like, it's like, when you, like, if you insult
they're
Hillary
insane.
Or insult the Democrats,
said,
it's like, yeah,
I
our
said
team.
In the Fox
you know,
News green
so
room,
strange.
I said, the fucking, I said the country is run by crime families. And then all the Republicans at Fox went, yeah, the Clintons. I'm like, the Bushes are in bed with Saudis.
Yeah.
What do you think? Like, they're Boy Scouts?
And then all of a sudden, they get outraged by the other side's bullshit.
Yeah.
Like, it's all just so...
It's all fake. Let's plug some dates here. That's we've solved the problem.
Sorry.
Sorry,
Lewis.
Half hours. Fuck you, Lewis. We got half hours coming out. Ramon, tell us where you're going
to
be.
Wait, we didn't even get to Lauren's divorce.
Oh, come on.
I didn't even know that was a thing.
Wait,
oh, Lauren,
I'm not allowed to say that?
Tim doesn't get it. Care about that.
I don't give a shit about that.
Is that not supposed to be brought up?
No, you can say it. We talked about it.
Oh, shit.
Congratulations.
Wait, what happened?
She's a free agent right now.
Nice. Divorced,
how's it feel to be back in the pool?
I don't really like it.
No?
Nah.
What do you
I'm just hanging right now.
Okay. Do you think maybe the problem is that your standards are too high?
Mm.
I mean, you are a divorce chick.
I just don't give a shit.
How long ago did this happen?
It's pretty recent, but it's been about a year now.
So. Yeah.
Oh shit!
Did
that's
you
a
get
long
to?
Time.
Did you get to like cuckold him before you left him?
What does that mean?
That like you had another man take you in
it's
front of him?
It's the porn that he likes.
I've never heard it pronounced
cuckold,
that way.
By the way.
Yeah. Did you cuckold him? Someone's only seen it in porn.
Was there a adjacent person in your?
Dude, I need a fucking thesaurus when Ramon's on the fucking.
Was it you, him, and an adjacent person sleeping with you while you watch him?
Do you have kids?
No.
Oh, okay.
I'm 29, so.
Oh, all right. Word. So you're okay.
Do you smoke weed?
I love how that's young now.
Okay.
Today it's just like,
no, I'm going to be 30.
You like Cleveland? You relocate?
Yeah. How do you like Cleveland?
No, 30's a dope.
It's like I'm only 29.
Not
know?
For a girl, though.
Just, I'm not thinking about
kids. No, dirty 30 is great for ladies.
Yeah.
That's when you stop, like, you're like, you know.
Nah, you're past your prime.
Yeah.
Now, 30's awesome for a dude.
Yeah, 30's awesome for a dude, not for me right now.
Yeah. No, I agree. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, I'm the only honest one.
No. I'm not happy because I'm gonna get the leftovers. Guys with kids.
But
guys
you're obviously
divorced.
Happy. You if you.
Oh,
nobody
yeah,
gets
yeah.
a divorce if like it
oh,
wasn't
right.
going good,
yeah,
right?
No, like,
now she's
no,
she's
happy.
Got a good point though. Like I'm still single and I assure you I'm broken.
Yeah.
So probably most people you're gonna meet.
No.
Oh yeah.
Saying,
yeah. They got a bag.
All right. Well,
so
that's
whatever.
A great note to end on. Everybody's broken. And Ramon, what's going on?
I will be August 26th through 28th is my comedy festival in Cleveland called Accidental Comedy Fest. If you go to accidentalcomedy.com, you get info on all the comics and musicians and podcasts that are happening that weekend. And then my half-hour special airs on the 26th, and I will be in Atlanta at the Relapse Theater in September.
Awesome. Is that part of Red Clay or no?
No, that's like the week before Red Clay.
I'm doing Red Clay. I'm excited about
that.
Oh,
Atlanta's amazing.
It's
going to
be great.
I had
no,
such a great time when
awesome.
I was in Atlanta.
Dave Smith.
Hey, buddy. I'm in the city the whole month, but I am opening for Nate at Caroline's on the 26th.
Nate Bargatze?
So yeah, Nate Bargatze. Great comedian and a good friend of all of ours. And Legion of Skanks every Wednesday. I do Part of the Problem, also on the Gas Digital Network, Mondays
great
and Fridays.
Podcast. I did that. I had a lot of fun.
And follow me on Twitter, Comic Dave Smith, all that good stuff. Yeah.
Puffers.
This Saturday.
Why don't you do it?
This Saturday. I'm going to be at one of my favorite clubs. I like it because you can bring your
family. I love
how
you get lower every time.
Bring your family to this club. It's the Knights of Columbus. Schenectady.
I'm actually going to be in Schenectady. No. Saturday, I'll be at Rockwell's in Pelham. The 13th. I love the room, actually. It's in Westchester. And then I will be co-headlining with Joe Bartnick at Mohegan Sun Comics at Mohegan Sun September 9th and 10th. And then I will be headlining the Tempe, Arizona Improv Wednesday, September 21st.
Great. Giannis.
I will be in Philadelphia from the 25th to the 27th at the Philadelphia Punchline. So get your tickets. They're available online. Also, my album is out right now on iTunes. My first album called Let Me Be Giannis. So go pick that up, please. Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming. Scopo.
If you're listening live, I got a show tomorrow night with Derek Gaines at Levity Live. And then Friday, I'm at the Brokerage
with Andrew Schultz. Come check that out.
Do you have anything to plug on the couch? We let people on the couch plug anything. You sure? All right. Lauren.
Just at Lauren Kubera on Twitter and Instagram. Okay. And then Depot go, and then I'll do Bobby's Days.
Okay. I'm going to do my shit.
Sure, what a great job you did, Phil.
You did it.
Yeah. It was a great job.
The chair
Thank
has
you very much.
No idea that Bobby's not here. I'm going to be at the Empire Casino with Sean Donnelly on August 17th. 18th through the 20th, I'll be in the Vermont Comedy Club with Dan Soder. Podcast Tim Dillon's Going to Hell, where we defend crime families, dictators, mob bosses. We defend evil people in society because nobody's doing that right now. We do it.
You talk about the Gotti kid?
What Gotti?
Will you stop with the Queen's fucking goodbye shit?
Selling our
Gotti. I'm defending the Saudis, not the fucking Gotti kid. Fucking nuts. Deepu.
I got a couple shows coming up. August 15th, I'll be at the Mockingbird in the East Village. And then on September 15th, I'll be doing a show at the Creek in the Cave. So you can check that out.
All right.
Oh, yeah. My website is BlazerRamone.com.
BlazerRamone.com. Anybody want to throw some websites out?
Yeah, follow
at
me on
Tim
Twitter,
J. Dillon, D-I-L-L-O-N on Twitter. And now we have Bobby Kelly, the man who's not here. Lauren's going to tell you some dates.
Go to RobertKellyLive.com. On August 30th, we're doing a live show, Creeps with Kids, at the Village Underground. It's going to be Bobby, Jim Florentine, Bonnie McFarlane, and Louis J. Gomez. It's going to be a great time.
Louis J. Gomez.
Premium membership. It'll be on the premium.
Yes. Gotta so be it'll premium. Be behind the wall. So you have to be a premium member to get that, $199. September 9th, 10th, he's going to be True Story Tour, Laugh It Up, Poughkeepsie, New York. September 16th, 17th at the Vermont Comedy Club in Burlington, Vermont. And just go to Robert Carey Live for all his dates.
Also, my new podcast, Robo vs. the Dog, with me and James Mattern. It's you can find it on SoundCloud, and it'll be available on iTunes very soon.
Robo vs. the Dog. Boom. Okay. Hey, everybody.
Hold on. If you want to email to sit on the couch like Doug did, go to ykwdproducer@riotcast.com. And if you want to send anything in, you go 117 McDougal Street, 10012, care of Robert Kelly.
All right.
Great job, Timmy Dillon.
Thanks for coming out. All right, guys. Have a good night.